in which we will examine the state of competition, diversity, and innovation in the video marketplace. Thank you all for coming, and thanks especially to our panelists, some of whom have traveled long distances to share their insights with us. The first workshop, held on March 21st, focused on marketplace challenges faced by distributors of video programming, including multi-channel video program distributors, MVPDs, and over-the-top providers, OVDs. Today's workshop will explore the challenges faced by smaller MVPDs and programmers that affect the ability of consumers to access diverse and independent content. I'm delighted that we will first have opening remarks by Commissioner Mignon Clyburn, who has provided great leadership to the Commission's exploration of these issues. Commissioner Clyburn.
Thank you, Mr. Lake. Good morning, everyone. We can do better than that because it's a glorious morning. Apparently, I don't know where you were, where you walked in, but let's try that again. Good morning, everyone. Fabulous. First, let me once again join in thanking our participants. Many, as you mentioned, traveled great distances to be here, for agreeing to take part in today's discussions, as well, of course, as the Media Bureau for hosting this workshop on the state of the video marketplace. On more than one occasion, each of you, if forced, will admit to being stuck in this vortex of perpetual channel flipping. This is a twilight zone state where your thumb has a mind of its own, but soon experiences a level of fatigue you never thought possible as it advances the directional channel button again and again and again. Don't act like you don't know what I'm talking about. You know you do. Or maybe you fancy yourself a bit more sophisticated. You are a channel cruiser who navigates the hundreds of television channels with advanced menu categories where you search in a more efficient and elegant manner. Whatever state of being describes you best, as each of you surf for programming, the same conclusion is drawn. Hundreds of channel options, but nothing you really care to watch. Many describe our current era as the golden age of television. We have access to a myriad of video programming from a variety of platforms, including broadcast, cable, and online streaming services. Still, when it comes to finding independent and diverse programming, I often hear the options are too few. Independent and diverse programmers from every conceivable ideological spectrum say that when it comes to offering much requested, desired, and needed niche programming to the masses, they face insurmountable challenges when it comes to program carriage. These challenges range from simply being able to acquire carriage, to difficulty receiving fair or reasonable contract terms, to prohibitions on growing their online distribution model because program distribution access is often restricted via contract. Is there an answer for those frustrated consumers seeking more diverse programming, as well as the programmers looking to expand their reach to more households? Is there a disconnect? And if the answer is yes, where is it? And does this all mean that our existing system is broken? And if so, who should fix it? These questions were among the many that led me to push for the notice of inquiry adopted by the Commission this past February. This fact-finding exercise asked many important questions, including whether Section 257 of the Communications Act provided the Commission with authority to impose regulations aimed at improving programming diversity. The NOI also asked whether the use of alternative distribution methods and most favored nation clauses thwart competition, diversity, or innovation. With increasing consolidation of the video marketplace, I also continue to hear from smaller operators who suggest that the practice of bundling constrains their ability to carry independent programming. The NOI asked about the impact of this practice, whether there are instances of independent programmers being dropped or not carried at all due to the constraints of bundling, and whether the move away from large pay TV bundles have had a disproportionate impact on these independent programmers. The comment period is now closed, but just over 36,000 comments have been filed in this docket, including many of which were filed by individual consumers. I continue to review the record, but I am confident that today's workshop will shed further light on these and other important questions. Last week at NAB, I questioned if potential benefits could come from the 3.0, which is a proposed next-generation broadcast standard. With its ability by some accounts to use a single 6 megahertz broadcast channel to distribute as many as 6 to 8 separate high-definition channels, I am eager to hear whether broadcasters would use this increased capacity, if so granted, to enhance diversity on the public airwaves. When the recently filed petition reaches the full commission, this will be among the key questions I intend to ask. Finally, our discussion of the video marketplace would not be complete without an examination of the over-the-top market and the potential it holds for enhancing access to independent and diverse programming. Of course, to truly enjoy this online content, consumers need access to affordable, robust, high-speed broadband. While I will save my thoughts on the state of the broadband marketplace for another day's discussion, there is no doubt great opportunity to expand the availability of niche content through online video platforms. According to a recent study released earlier this year by the USC's Amberg School for Communication and Journalism, streaming services are already doing better than mass market films when it comes to on-screen diversity. Of note, the study found that women held 10% more speaking roles on streaming services compared to those standard commercial films. Similarly, African Americans and other minority characters had nearly 3% more speaking roles on streaming services than in mass market films, which for now appears to mean that an increased number of media platforms helps to provide a voice for additional independent and diverse programming. Once again, I am grateful to all of you who made sacrifices to participate in this very important workshop, to those at the FCC, particularly the Media Bureau who organized this, and to those watching online, from home or at work. Thank you for tuning in, and I hope you have your boss's approval. With the completion of today's workshop, I am confident that we will have a clearer understanding of the challenges facing the video marketplace. Armed with this information, the Commission will be better poised to identify solutions that can enhance our access to independent and diverse voices. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Commissioner, and thanks for your leadership on these issues. Before we jump into today's agenda, I'll mention a few administrative matters. After each panel, we've allotted 30 minutes for questions from the audience. If you have a question for one of our panelists, please raise your hand and someone will bring you a mic. Alternatively, there are orange cards at the table near the door. You can write a question on one of them and place it in the tray. Because we hope to cover a lot of ground in a short time, we'll use a timer to help us stay on schedule. Panelists, we've allowed 10 minutes for each of your presentations. We ask that you monitor the timer so that you can stay within that time period. Like the last workshop, this one is being streamed live and captioned, and it will be posted on the FCC website. For those staying for the entire day, there's a handout describing local lunch options, such as they are, on the table near the door. Now, briefly to review the day's agenda. We have two panels today, for which we've allotted an hour each, plus the 30 minutes for questions. Before the first panel, Tasneem Chipti, Managing Principal of the Analysis Group, will give us some useful background on the issues we'll be discussing today. Then the first panel, to begin around 10:30, will discuss the challenges faced by smaller MVPDs that affect their carriage of independent programming. Michelle Carey, Deputy Chief of the Media Bureau, will moderate that panel. We'll follow that panel with a lunch break beginning around noon. After lunch, we'll resume promptly at 1 p.m. with the second and last panel. It will discuss challenges faced by independent programmers who seek carriage on video distribution platforms. I will moderate that panel. Now I'm happy to introduce Tasneem Chipti, who, as I mentioned, is managing principal of the Analysis Group, an international economics consulting firm. She was a member of the panel at our first workshop that discussed challenges faced by MVPDs, and she's an expert in industrial organization, antitrust economics, and econometrics. Ms. Chipti, welcome.
So good morning, everyone. I'm very pleased to help kick off today's event, and I thank the Media Bureau for inviting me to participate. As you've already heard, today's session is focused on the obstacles that may prevent the provision of independent and diverse programming. The panelists here today, both the morning and the afternoon session, are industry participants, the smaller MVPDs, and the independent programmers. I myself am, in some sense, an outside voice. I'm neither here at the FCC nor one of the industry participants. I am, however, as Mr. Lake just described, an antitrust economist, and I've been studying issues from all aspects of the cable industry since probably the mid-1980s. So I share with you today some background that I hope will help frame the discussion. I will also share some of my observations that might speak to some of these issues. Okay, so let me start. I have a slide deck. Maybe I start. Okay, let's start. The first slide here, just to set the stage, describes the MVPDs serving the traditional subscriber landscape. Okay, so the top 10 MVPDs serve about 90% of all cable television subscribers. Hundreds of smaller MVPDs serve the remaining 10%. Okay, so the smaller MVPDs, we're about to hear from their perspective, the smaller MVPDs face different supply and demand conditions. They tend to serve smaller, more rural areas. They are less likely to be all digital, which means that they have less bandwidth to offer things like additional digital channels, additional high-definition channels, and certainly constraints on providing faster internet speeds. The smaller MVPDs also have less leverage, obviously, with the large programmers. Another basic fact is that the industry is going over the top. MVPDs themselves are offering their subscribers access to content over the air. Content providers, traditional content providers like the broadcast networks, the cable networks, and the sports leagues themselves are going direct to viewers. And a host of other options are available to customers today. Viewers can use these services both as substitutes and as complements to their traditional cable subscription. The industry is clearly trying to figure out how to operate in this new video landscape, enabled in large part by technologies in devices, technological advances in devices, as well as the high-speed internet speeds that are available. There's a lot we don't know, but what we certainly know is that customers, viewers like to watch. They like to watch how they want, when they want, and where they want. And in large part because of this, what we're seeing is that the over-the-top subscriber services are achieving subscriber numbers that are comparable, if not more impressive in some ways, than traditional MVPD numbers. So this next slide actually describes the top 20 video subscription services in the U.S. The purple rows are the OTT subscription services, and the other rows are the MVPD subscription services. The numbers are small, so if you can't read, I'll tell you that the top three OTT providers here, Netflix, Amazon, and Hulu, collectively sell subscriptions that exceed the collective subscriptions of the top six MVPDs. So if you look at this chart, you might get the impression that OTT distribution is really rivaling traditional MVPD distribution. But it's more complicated than that. The fact is that the vast majority of OTT service subscribers aren't satisfied with just their OTT subscription. Most of these folks also have traditional MVPD subscriptions. Okay, so let's turn to programmers. Okay, the single biggest challenge facing programmers, after, of course, the need to attract talent and create ideas, is the ability to access viewers. So while there appear to be more opportunities to reach viewers today than ever before, it is unclear whether a programmer, given the subscriber patterns I just told you about, can succeed without carriage by a sufficiently large number of MVPDs. Okay, so the practices that may interfere with access, vertical integration, most favored nations provisions, ADM provisions, and wholesale bundling. I think we'll hear a lot more about these today, but let me set the stage by telling you a little bit from the economics perspective about the pushes and the pulls associated with each one. Okay, actually, I'll focus just on the first three and not the wholesale bundling in the interest of time. We spent a lot of time on wholesale bundling at the first of the FCC events, at least the economics of it. So let me focus on the other three. Let's start with vertical integration. The concern is that vertically integrated MVPDs will deny carriage to rival independent programmers. However, there's no guarantee that the incentives will work out this way, especially in an age of increased competition in distribution. So in thinking about whether or not to carry a program service, a vertically integrated MVPD will do what we call the profit arithmetic. They'll weigh the pros and the cons of carriage versus denying carriage. So I've described here on this slide carriage incentives and carriage disincentives. You could think about comparable profit arithmetic that instead of asking should you carry, you might ask should you drop. But I've set it up as should you carry. So on the plus side, a vertically integrated MVPD might benefit from carrying a rival program service in at least two ways. Okay. They might find it attractive. Because subscribers find it attractive, they might find it attractive. So to the extent carrying this, the network, the competing network, allows them to sell more subscriptions, the MVPD can earn the entire bundle margin. Okay. It's possible that by offering a more attractive package, the MVPD can also earn greater revenues from existing sales. So this means carriage of a rival might let the MVPD improve their bundle margin, not just earn their bundle margin. On the disincentive side is the fear, the possibility that carrying a rival will cannibalize viewership and ad revenues of your own network. Okay, so in figuring out whether or not the incentives are going to work out towards lack of carriage or towards barriers to access, we'd have to figure out whether the pushes and the pulls work out this way. The two key factors that you'll have to assess in determining whether vertical integration actually poses a barrier is determining whether the independent programming is sufficiently desirable, because if it is, the incentives will outweigh the disincentives. And also figuring out whether there's direct competition between the independent programming and the vertically integrated network. How substitutable are they? The more substitutable they are, the greater is the risk of cannibalization. So these would be the factors, and in my view, they would have to be weighed on a case-by-case basis. Okay, the next set of practices are these alternative distribution method provisions. So what are they? Okay. An ADM is a provision that restricts a programmer's ability to distribute their programming in a particular way. Okay, so a carriage agreement may specify that the programmer cannot distribute its network for some specified period of time via an alternative distribution method, which we traditionally think of as over the top, but it need not be. But in a manner that in an alternative manner that reaches subscribers in the MVPD service territory. Okay, so in a sense, an ADM provision is a form of exclusivity. Okay, it's a form of exclusivity that's specified in a particular way. The concern is that these types of provisions will slow competition from online services. The concern is that they will make it more difficult for programmers to reach viewers, and that ultimately all of this will result in diminished incentives to invest in programming. So these are the concerns. On the other side, there may be some pro-competitive justifications for the use of ADM provisions. If you talk to at least some of the larger MVPDs that sometimes ask for them, You might hear them say that ADM provisions are necessary in order for them to figure out what they're actually paying for. In this sense, you might think of an ADM provision as a feature of the contract that defines the contours of the rights being purchased. Okay, so if there can be a more precise way to describe what is being purchased, the parties could figure out what that those rights are worth to them. And so I've heard that ADM provisions are viewed from the perspective of MVPDs who demand them as this form of information clarifying for them. Okay, they also protect the programmer from, so say the MVPDs, from a potential downward spiral to zero. Okay, the logic kind of goes like this. If the same content is available to viewers through an alternative distribution method, particularly at a lower price, this will erode the consumer's value for that programming on the MVPD service, which in turn will erode the MVPD's willingness to pay for that service. And in this manner, MVPDs describe that ADM provisions actually help promote incentives to invest because they protect an erosion or a downward spiral to zero. Okay, so these are the different arguments that you'll hear from industry participants and certainly that I've heard. The third practice, the MFN provisions. Okay, so a carriage agreement may specify that an MVPD is entitled to receive any more favorable term negotiated by other MVPDs for the same content. MFN provisions can take many forms. There can be conditional MFNs. That means an MVPD can receive the benefit of one term if they also provide, if they also satisfy a host of other terms that the other MVPDs agreed to satisfy. There can be unconditional MFNs, which are also known as cherry-picking MFNs. Those are potentially the most aggressive ones because they say they may be interpreted that the MVPD with the MFN provision is entitled to the best terms. They can cherry-pick the collection of terms that others have negotiated without regard to the bundle of terms that a particular MVPD might have agreed to. And so the concern really is that the MFN places upward pressure on prices because it reduces the programmer's incentives to cut price to any one MVPD, because doing so would trigger their MFN obligations on a host of others. Okay, so that's the single biggest concern. There are pro-competitive justifications that you'll hear MVPDs give for the use of MFNs. Probably the most common one I've heard is that MFN provisions help reduce holdout or delay in negotiations. I'm told that MVPDs are assured when they hear that they're not getting the worst deal. In fact, they're getting the same deal as some of the larger MVPDs. And so again, there are pro-competitive and anti-competitive justifications for MFNs, and they're certainly used in other industries. Okay, so let's turn now to the programming landscape. According to SNL Kagan, there are about 200 national basic cable networks in the country today. Of these, 18 are vertically integrated, and about 180 are independent. Okay, the chart actually breaks down. I broke out independent programmers into three categories. Those that, and I'm counting networks, so I broke the network counts into three categories. The top 50 independent networks, there are in fact 43 of the top 50 networks are independent networks. Independent networks that are affiliated with a top 50 network, and then non-top 50 networks. That means independent networks that are not affiliated, that are neither a top 50 nor are they affiliated with a top 50. Okay, so let's look at this chart. And, of course, the second column tells you the collective share of primetime ratings that this each of the groups or subgroups generates or accounts for. Okay, let's look at this pattern here. Based on this chart, it would seem to me, and I will probe a little further, but certainly let's just look at what's on this chart. The independent networks appear to be doing quite well by some metrics. Okay, here are some observations. First, there are a lot of them, at least relative to the vertically integrated networks. Second, they account for 43 of the top 50 cable networks based on primetime ratings. Third, the independent networks among the top 50 include some of the programming giants like Disney and Viacom. Okay, and they actually achieve higher primetime ratings on a per-network basis than the vertically integrated networks. Okay, and so by these metrics, at least superficially, it appears like the independent networks are doing probably quite well. Okay, it doesn't go to diversity, but it goes to numbers and presence in the marketplace. Okay, and finally, an interesting fact, if you stare at the last category of networks, a non-top 50 independent network does better on a primetime ratings basis if they are affiliated with a top 50 independent network. Okay, and I'm kind of interested in why is that, and there are some explanations people might have, perhaps related to wholesale bundling. Okay, so because today's session is focused on obstacles for the that might affect the provision of independent programming, I wanted to drill a little further. Okay, so I look at the success of new networks launched between 2005 and 2007. There were 53 networks launched in this time period. Okay, of these six, depending on how you count the VOOM suite, so six were launched by MVPDs, and 47 were launched by independent owners. And so we traced them, and we asked, are they still on the air today, and what's going on with them? So, in fact, we traced them, and what we see is that some are on the air, some are not on the air. And if you stare at this pattern, looking at the survival rates alone, the networks launched by the independents are just as likely, if not more likely, to survive than networks launched by MVPDs, or what we might call the vertically integrated networks. Okay, and this is probably largely because of the giant independent programmers that launched networks. Okay, so I wanted to drill a little bit further to split out the effect of the giant independent networks and perhaps get a little more to the ability of a smaller independent network to survive. So what the next chart does is it breaks out those 47 networks launched by independent owners into whether or not the then owner that launched that network was also an owner of a top 50 network. This will single out the Disneys and the Viacoms and so forth. Okay, and so you can see that of the 47 networks, 20 were launched by a then owner of a top 50, and 27 were launched by not a then owner of a top 50. And then we could do the same exercise. And what you see here is that a newly launched network is somewhat more likely to survive. A newly launched independent network is somewhat more likely to survive if it is launched by an owner that owns other popular programming. Okay, but the difference is not that stark. So then we could go further. And so what you see at the very bottom are the average primetime ratings achieved today by those networks. So what you see is that new networks launched by owners of current popular programming are able to achieve significantly more viewing of their networks. So, in fact, the difference is a factor of 15. Okay, so for whatever the many reasons are, the good and the bad reasons, being large matters and being vertically integrated matters. But it's really the small guys that are having a hard time breaking through. But it's unclear what explains this advantage. Is it that independent owners of popular programming are using practices like wholesale bundling to advantage their newly launched networks, or is it simply the case that they're better at launching and creating programming? Okay, so let me end with some challenges. I know the purpose of today is to talk about challenges facing small MVPDs and independent programmers, but I would like to conclude with thinking about the challenges facing the Media Bureau and the FCC. Okay. The Commission needs to distinguish between competitive and anti-competitive behavior. The types of questions the Commission probably should be asking, probably is asking, is where is the market power? Okay, are there legitimate business reasons for the observed contracting practices, or are they retarding the competition that would have existed otherwise? If so, where should we be looking for adverse effects? What would the but-for world look like? Should we look to these contracting practices to explain the rising programming costs? Are they crowding out smaller independent programmers? Is there slower OVD growth? I described that there was OVD growth, but is there slower growth than there would have been otherwise? And the commission will also need to figure out whether the marketplace, despite the obstacles, is getting there anyway, is getting to a place where consumers have increasing choices for programming and also ways in which to watch their programming. And in this context, it's noteworthy, and I've showed you the some of the basic facts, there has been a proliferation of technologies and business models. Okay. There have been new entrants in programming, including OVDs like Amazon and Hulu, who are creating their own original and, I might add, exclusive programming. And we see consumers have more choices today. I don't know if you click and you find nothing, but there are lots of people who are clicking and finding things also. Okay, so let me end with that, and let me turn it over to Michelle, who will kick off the first panel.
Thank you, Tasmin. All right, we're going to go into our first panel, and our first panel, as Bill mentioned, is challenges faced by MVPDs that affect carriage of independent programming. And we have some expert panelists here. Thank you so much for joining us today. To my left is Judy Micah. She's Executive Vice President of Programming for the National Cable Television Cooperative, NCTC. Next to her is Heather McCallion. She's Vice President of Programming at Atlantic Broadband. Next to her is Chris Kyle, Vice President of Industry Relations and Regulatory at Shentel. Next to him is Duke Milunovic, Sales and Marketing Director of Volcano Vision Incorporated. And finally, Jimmy Todd, Chief Executive Officer and General Manager of Nextech. So we'll start with Judy. If you want to give your presentation, we'll go down the line, and then we will open it up for questions.
Thank you, Michelle. As Michelle said, my name is Judy Micah. I am the Executive Vice President of Programming for the National Cable Television Co-op, or NCTC. I would like to thank you for allowing me to provide my thoughts on issues related to programming diversity today. I hope to provide you with an overview of the market from my perspective and from my experience in negotiating master programming agreements for 850 or so smaller cable operators, all with unique viewpoints and serving diverse communities. My career negotiating programming agreements spans over 20 years, and I have had the opportunity to negotiate programming agreements with all of the large programming media groups, as well as numerous independent programmers. And I should note that when we refer to independent programmers, we really are talking about not the large programming groups. The large programming groups, given their size and the amount of leverage, we don't refer to them as independent programmers. Independent programmers do face a number of challenges in obtaining distribution of their content by NCTC members. Small cable operators are often better positioned to provide diverse programming given their demographics. They would like to offer programming, diverse programming, and independent programming that is consistent with their customers' interests. The tactics engaged in, though, by some large programming providers, however, impede their ability to do so. Most significantly, this includes forced bundling and onerous penetration guarantees. All large programmers engage in forced bundling to some degree. In order to carry what is considered a must-have network, an operator is required to carry a number of other networks, some of which are far less desirable channels with low ratings and with little or no consumer demand. NCTC has agreements in place with the 9 largest programming providers today. Those agreements represent well over 100 different cable networks. Because of bundling, an NCTC member seeking to distribute just one network from each of those 9 agreements would be required to carry up to 65 channels in total and potentially more in certain circumstances. Forced bundling takes up a tremendous amount of often scarce bandwidth that could be used for independent programming or for other services. Members routinely feel frustrated with bundling, as we hear from them often. When members prefer to distribute an independent network, they are unable to do so given the capacity and the cost that they must allocate to the bundled channels of the larger programmers. Programmers, however, generally ignore the concerns about cost and capacity. Recently, one programmer suggested that NCTC members reallocate bandwidth from their broadband offerings to video in order to comply with the programmer's bundling demand. Programmers use their leverage very aggressively to force members to take their bundles. Contrary to what they often publicly state, large programmers are not willing to negotiate for unbundled or standalone rates. NCTC has tried multiple times to obtain standalone rates from large programmers. They have either ignored our requests or they have told us that while standalone rates exist, our members would not be interested in them. Penetration requirements also cause a huge problem from a diversity perspective. Penetration guarantees can be structured in many different ways, but they all essentially require distribution to almost all subscribers and on an expanded basic level of service. So independent networks, if carried at all, often appear on less widely distributed, less popular, and more expensive tiers. Programmers argue that penetration requirements are entirely the result of back-and-forth negotiations and an exchange of value. That's not been my experience. They forcefully pursue penetration and packaging requirements, and they generally refuse to treat those requirements as the subject of any meaningful negotiation. NCTC members view these requirements as detrimental to their ability to support programming diversity and to offer consumers more choice. In my experience, the large programmers use every conceivable tactic to enforce their bundles and to ensure that they remain intact. Once a member carries a particular channel, for example, a programmer almost never allows it to stop doing so in future negotiations, regardless of that channel's performance. Programmers also enforce bundles by using misleading and disruptive messages and crawls on their networks. They limit access to free programming on their websites, and they use RSNs and broadcast stations as leverage. For all of these reasons, the FCC should proceed to a rulemaking. I also understand there are a number of pending proceedings where the commission can take more immediate steps to address these issues. For example, the program access statute permits buying groups to bring complaints, but outdated rules prevent the NCTC, the most utilized buying group in the market, from doing so. The ACA has been urging the FCC to update the rules for more than 3 years, and I support those efforts. Thank you again for allowing me to participate in this workshop, and I'm happy to answer any questions you might have.
Thank you, Judy. Heather?
Great. Thank you for having us and for allowing us to have a voice here. I'm Heather McCallion. I'm Vice President of Programming at Atlantic Broadband. Atlantic Broadband offers internet, cable television, and phone service to roughly 245,000 video customers in 8 states across the Eastern Seaboard. I oversee deal negotiation, implementation, and compliance for all of the company's video content. I've negotiated agreements with large programming groups directly, and I've opted into master agreements negotiated by Judy and the NCTC. I'll begin by aligning myself with Judy's remarks. I've seen the negotiation behavior she describes. I've experienced firsthand the insistence by large programmers that Atlantic Broadband accept less popular channels in order to maintain the carriage of must-have content. These bundled channels are generally presented as non-negotiable table stakes at the outset of the negotiation, with no room to lower carriage thresholds or carry only the channels we want. As Judy noted, this holds true for the NCTC deals as well. For some perspective, in 2016 alone, Atlantic Broadband will expand distribution for more than 15 networks. That will cost us over $1.5 million. None of these networks are independent. But my focus will be more on the effect that this behavior has on diversity interests, particularly as they relate to the traditional MVPD carriage. There are two main areas of impact that limit Atlantic Broadband's ability to offer independent programming: bandwidth capacity and cost. Chris Kyle of Shentel will focus on the effects of broadband video next, which I echo as well. But let's talk about capacity. So every bundled launch requirement consumes additional system bandwidth. Atlantic broadband systems range from 330 megahertz in size to 1 gigahertz in total capacity. Systems with 750 megahertz of capacity or less serve more than half of Atlantic broadband's customers, and many still transmit basic and expanded basic tiers in analog. Because analog channels require 12 times the bandwidth of digital channels, broadening distribution for a single channel in analog, which is often the bundling requirement of large programmers, takes up the space that could go to multiple independent programmers in digital. In addition, we are still launching HD channels in many markets, and we also have to meet rapidly increasing demands for higher internet speeds, both of which require significant bandwidth. Atlantic Broadband has invested heavily in capital to expand capacity. We are budgeted to invest millions next year for system upgrades, but the aggressive bundling requirements of big programmers quickly consume the newly created bandwidth, leaving little room for independent programmers or other products like high-speed or HD. And these upgrades and investments are not always a long-term solution. Further, forced bundling may offer diverse networks by a big programmer's definition, but this diverse programming does not match the viewing preference or in our subscriber markets. For example, to carry a certain Spanish-language broadcast network in Miami, we must also carry a new Hispanic cable channel in markets beyond Miami. They have less than 2% Hispanic penetration. A market like Cumberland, Maryland, can't offer better-suited channels like RFD TV, MAV TV, or outside television because of these types of mandates. Likewise, we have to carry a specific sports network to customers in states well outside of that sports network's conference as a result of a larger programming deal. In these outer areas, that network receives very low viewership. It ranks 190th among all networks versus 27th in viewership when carried in a market located within the conference. An independent programmer might draw higher viewership for that out-of-market territory, but that choice is not at our discretion. In one particular bundling case, the larger negotiation required deeper distribution of a network that was not yet launched. It was literally a channel to be named later. Of course, there's no way to determine whether a channel fits our audience's need if we don't even know what that channel is. Now let's talk about cost. The cost of bundling equally impacts our ability to carry independent channels. It limits the money we can spend on any other programming that is not contractually required. Costs have always gone up, due in large part to bundling, but we have experienced double-digit increases in each of the last 3 years. Atlantic Broadband subscribers are disproportionately older and in lower-income areas, and there are limits to how much cost we can pass on to them. When you're facing double-digit increases in programming costs and you're forced to raise rates by more than $5 a year, there's absolutely no room to spend another discretionary penny on independent programmers. Indeed, we've actually removed independent networks from our lineup to reclaim cost and bandwidth. Independent programmers are more vulnerable to this than networks owned by larger programmers with must-have content. Large programmers also demand extremely high penetration levels for much of their programming, and they allow little flexibility in packaging. These penetration requirements are prevalent in all large NCTC agreements, as well as the programming deals we negotiate directly. Penetration requirements can be expressed in many ways, as a percentage of total video subs, a requirement for a specific tier, or some combination of both. Some provide exceptions for basic or alternate tiers, but they limit the number of subs who can take that tier. None of these exceptions provide enough room to truly create choice, including independent programming. But even when Atlantic Broadband does discuss the addition of a new independent programmer, there are other obstacles. Large MVPDs almost always include most favored nation clauses in their deals with independent programmers, which permit them to cherry-pick the most favorable terms for the carriage of that programmer. So if a network has gotten a certain penetration percentage or a discrete fee from an MVPD, and Atlantic Broadband can't meet those same terms, a deal can't be reached. That independent programmer would risk losing the penetration or license fee already negotiated with the larger MVPD. For independent programmers, flexibility and creativity for these negotiations are limited in many cases due to MFNs. In terms of what the Commission can do, I agree with Judy. Forced bundling significantly increases cost for both us and our customers, and it consumes precious bandwidth that could be put to more valuable use. Fixing the loophole that prevents NCTC from bringing program access complaints would be very helpful. It would also be helpful for the FCC to address these issues under its retransmission consent rules. Atlantic Broadband has encountered many of the behaviors that harm diversity in the context of retransmission consent negotiations. I'd urge you to consider in particular the proposals offered by the ACA and others in that proceeding. I'm grateful for the opportunity to present Atlantic Broadband's perspective on these issues, and I'm happy to answer any questions that you might have. Thank you.
Thank you, Heather. Chris?
Good morning, everybody. My name is Chris Kyle. I'm the Vice President of Industry Relations and Regulatory at a company called Shentel. We provide cable service to more than 50,000 subscribers, including many low-income customers in small markets and rural communities in Virginia and West Virginia. I'd like to add my thanks to the FCC for letting me speak today also. Like Heather's company, Shentel receives some of its cable programming by negotiating directly with programmers, which is part of my job, and some by opting into master programming agreements negotiated by the NCTC. And like both Judy and Heather, I can report that programmers demand burdensome penetration requirements that require Shentel to carry numerous unwanted channels. In my experience, these bundles are always included as part of a take-it-or-leave-it offer. They consistently harm Shentel, which would always prefer the option of carrying only the individual networks its subscribers actually want to watch. We find that much of the programming that comes bundled is a poor fit with the interests of our subscribers, and we would prefer to pick independent channels that better serve their needs. I too have had some experience with a broadcaster and a channel to be named later. In fact, that channel has just been named, and the rate is every bit as bad as I had feared. This has diversity consequences both in terms of budget. I have less money for independent programmers, and also capacity. I have less room for independent programmers. I would like to focus, however, on the effect of the behavior Judy and Heather and I have seen on broadband video, which I think we can all agree holds just tremendous promise for diversity. To begin with, our ability to provide broadband video of sufficient quality and speed depends on capacity. Over 5 years ago, Shentel embarked on a plan to build a high-quality network for internet service with the expectation that the future of the video marketplace lies in online programming. As part of that process, we have spent well over $160 million for systems that pass only 170,000 homes. About half of our systems are now completely digital, and all of our systems have 750 megahertz capacity or more. Particularly given the bandwidth demands of HD channels, however, forced bundling creates capacity constraints even on these systems and strains Shentel's ability to offer the internet service it considers a top priority. Indeed, even some of Shentel's 1 gigahertz systems have no more than 5 channels left for video or increased internet capacity. Based on current data utilization trends and increased internet demand from residential customers in those markets, Shentel anticipates needing all of those remaining channels just for broadband capacity. Though these systems are capacity constrained, they receive no relief from the bundling demands of the programmers. While we can take some steps to extract extra capacity from these systems, these steps are extremely expensive. We are investing, but we could spend millions to increase capacity, and it still wouldn't be enough. The bottom line, every bundled channel we carry takes away capacity that could be used for broadband, and specifically broadband video.
Penetration requirements also hinder our ability to provide broadband video. Shentel's customers are increasingly calling for skinny bundles. Those that carry only more cable, Shentel's customers are increasingly calling for skinny bundles, carrying only core cable channels at lower prices. Shentel is eager to provide this option, since it would serve as a tool for subscribers to gradually make the transition to getting much of their television content through broadband video. Shentel's hands are largely tied, however. For example, if a provider requires their programming to be distributed to 85% of Shentel's total customers, in addition to other tiering requirements, Shentel can only provide a skinny bundle option to approximately 2,000 of our subscribers before we cross that 85% threshold. In addition, Shentel is not free to select the programming to include in that package due to other content restrictions, and Shentel can only offer this package as a save. That is, we can offer it only to subscribers that call us threatening to switch to another provider, and we are not allowed to advertise this package. High penetration levels and similar constraints limit the appeal and effectiveness of any potential skinny bundle. In addition, the distribution requirements effectively force Shentel to carry a large number of channels, many of them barely watched, in an expanded basic tier. So although Shentel would prefer for its subscribers to receive more of their video programming online, Shentel cannot offer an attractive or viable skinny bundle that would allow our customers to cord shave. In terms of remedies, I would also agree with Judy and Heather. The FCC should fix its program rules to allow NCTC to file complaints. And it certainly should do something to address retransmission consent. I have to say I find the whole channel to be named later situation incredibly frustrating. So I hope the Commission takes action on retransmission consent very soon. Thank you.
Thank you, Chris. Duke?
Greetings from sunny California. I'm here representing Volcano Vision. We are a division of the Volcano Telephone Company, an ILEC that was established in our neck of the woods. How do we get this thing going here? There we go. And you can see that map of the state, that red blotch on it is where we operate. We have about 420 square miles of territory that we cover. We are in the Sierra Nevada mountains, very mountainous terrain, very tree-laden terrain, very rural. 3,100 video subscribers, 9,100 telephone access lines, 6,600 internet subscribers that are being delivered, served via DSL, cable modem services in a smaller market of 1,100 internet subscribers, and fixed wireless outside of both of those wireline territories of 600 Wi-Fi subscribers today. We are part of the Sacramento-Stockton-Modesto DMA, and we're and have been in the MVPD business since 1983 when the FCC granted us an exemption. A little bit about the structure of our network. We operate two networks. The hybrid fiber coax network is an overbuild of our telco territories. The technologies that were available when we got into this business in 83 did not allow for any type of video transmission over the existing telephone company networks, and the HFC network was built to do that. We still operate under those conditions. There we go. We have an 860 megahertz plant. It's envious, actually. 100% the digital system. We did this about 8 years ago, and one of the first small independents in the country to go 100% digital. At the time, MPEG-2 technology was the state of the art for encoding and encryption of those signals, and we are still an MPEG-2 system. We provide HD and SD services today. All of our set-top boxes, or the vast majority of them, are MPEG-2 set-top boxes, which are now starting to show their age. We operate our own digital head end with off-air antennas pulling in signals from 40 to 50 miles away in the Sacramento area. Satellite reception and now broadband content feeds coming in terrestrially as well. We are also video on demand enabled. We offer 300 uncompressed video channels, 78 of them in high definition. Our picture qualities are outstanding. 8 local HD broadcast channels from the Sacramento DMA, 8 and now 11 multicasts. 2 local community access channels, 2 regional sports networks, 50 stereo commercial-free audio channels, 3 premium channel multiplexes, an electronic program guide, the iGuide, and video on demand and TV everywhere, most recently services added to the mix. We offer 3 programming packages today, and the reason I have this up here, and I've posted the pricing as well so that you can get an idea of some of the discussions that have been going on here today. We have a Lifeline package. That's a PEGs, FCC PEG package that includes the Lifeline channels, the public access, educational, and government services, kind of a Lifeline type service. Basic Pack, which is our expanded basic, with 136 video channels, 50 audio, and our Select Pack of 178 video channels, 50 audio. I'd like you to note the pricing, however, and also note that there's a package that was up here until recently, about a year and a half, 2 years ago, that was our skinny bundle that we put together back when we went all digital, that had about 80 channels in it, included primarily, exclusively family package product. We were forced to withdraw that product, however, from the marketplace because of the penetration requirements of our existing agreements. We have grandfathered the package since, and those customers have remained very loyal, but we too came across a situation where percentages of penetration became cost prohibitive through penalties through the agreements. So note, however, that our Lifeline package is $30.70 a month. That includes the retransmission consent charges. The next step up, what we call our basic pack, is $85.60 a month. That's a $55 increase, and there's nothing in between. That's probably the biggest complaint I get from our subscribers. We also offer the a la carte premium multiplexes. We have 3 set-top box choices today, a standard definition box that we rent for $2.99 a month. One is included with the service at no charge. We have high definition set-tops at $7.99 a month, and HD DVRs at $13.99 a month. No additional outlet fees, no separate HD technologies fees, and up to 4 outlets. This is talking about system capacity issues. MPEG-2, high bandwidth, rapidly aging encoding process. No insult intended to the folks in the photograph there. The continued migration to HD channels at 4 times the bandwidth of a standard definition channel is becoming problematic for us. As I'd mentioned, we have 78 of them today. The upcoming introduction of the Ultra HD or 4K services, we still don't know what the impact of that's going to be, except that it will, in fact, require additional bandwidth to be able to provide that to our customers. We face continued growth on the on-demand side of the house. All of that takes capacity. Every consumer that's pulling up an on-demand asset to view at their leisure is drawing capacity off of our networks, and that the rate of that continues to grow. We also have continued pressure for increased broadband speeds and more capacity to be delivered along those lines. That grows rapidly, and if you're not aware, some of the 4K assets that Netflix are distributing today require, they recommend 25 megabits of broadband stream to deliver that single signal. We face an expanding universe of content availability. That's what all the folks are here to talk about today. It's a great time for television. There is an enormous amount of content available, assets available, to reach just about any interest that a consumer may have. But that also requires capacity to deliver. The other thing that we face as an industry is sophistication in the user interfaces. It's becoming more and more difficult to wade through that sea of content. So there's a constant pressure to improve those interfaces. A typical Volcano Vision subscriber today is paying about $107.59 a month. That doesn't include the taxes, franchise fees, or anything else. $60.57 of that is programming. This customer would be receiving our expanded basic with video on demand and TV everywhere, HD DVR and HD set-top box and a single standard definition set-top box. But the prices climb each year, driven almost exclusively by the additional programming costs that we're seeing. I've heard mention of $5 rate increases. We had a year where we had an $8 increase when we had simultaneous retransmission consent increases hit at the same time. So what are our consumers saying? It's too expensive. It's getting to be burdensome for a lot of our customers. We have an older population, an older demographic, many of them on fixed incomes. And they're saying, you guys are killing us. This is happening way too frequently. It's a yearly event now. They ask questions like, why do I have to buy all these channels that I don't watch? There's a common complaint. We've all heard that one in the room, right? We estimate that 70 to 80% of our customers have no interest in any of the sports programming, for instance, and it's the most expensive programming on the slate. I like your TV service, but why can't you offer me lower prices and more choices? That's got to be the single biggest complaint we hear from folks. Goes back to those three packages that I referred to earlier. They'd like to see more choice. And why do I need the SEC network? After all, I'm here on the West Coast. I'd really like Pac-12. So what does all this really come down to? It's about the current pay TV business model that we face. It's been mentioned before, the forced bundling from the large programmers. It consumes capacity and becomes ever more costly. Those costs have to be passed on to the consumer. We have restrictive penetration requirements. That was what led to us eliminating one of the packages that we were offering. The MFN clauses become really restrictive and problematic when we talk about bringing on independent programmers. We're paying more for our content than the large MVPDs are. We know that for a fact. We don't know how much more, but we estimate it could be as high as 20% more. Very limited capability to create skinny bundles or genre-based packages, which we get requests for all of the time. In summary, I'd just like to thank you for your attention, and best wishes from Pine Grove, California. Come see us sometime.
Thank you, Duke.
No. They're famous for the cookies.
The commissioner visited us about 6 or 7 years ago. Wonderful. Thank you.
Thank you, Duke. We'll turn next to Jimmy.
Thank you. I'm Jimmy Todd, CEO and General Manager for Nextech. Nextech is an organization with its roots being that of a rural telecommunications cooperative. As telecom has evolved, so has our organization changed and to become a highly diversified communications and technology company. Similarly, the focus of communications for our customers, which began as landline voice services, both local and long distance, now includes high-speed broadband internet and television services necessary for our rural community. Nextech has nearly 14,000 television subscribers, and that's across a 9,300 square mile service area in northwest and north central Kansas. Our primary television service offering is IP-based video via fiber optic infrastructure. And on an annual basis, we're involved in negotiating programming contracts with the goal of keeping costs reasonable for our customers. Sadly enough, each year we continue to see ever-increasing rates for content, and there are additional requirements that lead to hidden costs over the term of these contracts. Many of the content providers require the service provider to take a bundle of channels within its portfolio. And while some may argue that this adds diversity for the viewers, I would argue that it increases cost and in some ways actually limits diversity for our viewers. Bundle rates continue to rise, and in order to have the more popular content, a multi-channel video programming distributor is forced to take less desirable content, which also has a cost. The chief obstacle that content bundling presents in providing service to our end users is the cost itself. Many contracts require that the bundled channels be included in the most widely viewed package. So intuitively, the cost of that most widely viewed channel lineup continues to rise, and in both the number of channels and in the cost for the package. Ultimately, this results in an ever-increasing cost to overall price for television, and it makes it more challenging for a small provider to add independent networks and to offer smaller channel lineups. If there was an option to unbundle without paying a premium, it would allow the MVPD the opportunity to add more diverse content programming options for its customer base. With a fiber to the home network, we really don't have any significant capacity constraints in the distribution network beyond the head end equipment needed to process the signal and transition the content to light so that it travels the glass fibers in our network infrastructure. As expected, though, the head-end equipment necessary for adding channels also has a cost. Usually that's not taken into consideration. Our goal is to provide excellent service at a reasonable cost, but in many ways we are unable to impact the cost that our customers must bear for television service. One of the few ways we can control cost is not to add optional channels to the lineup. Most of our customers would like to have more a la carte options, or at least the ability to choose smaller packages that align more with their interest. We believe that if the FCC truly had the best interest of the consumer in mind, it would see that market dynamics left unregulated in this arena have not met this goal. Our customer base has a median household income slightly above $30,000. As rates continue to increase for video service, many of our customers are being forced to make cuts. In the past, the term cord cutting pertained to the loss of landline telephone, so voice subscribers. However, last year, we saw this trend was more evident in video subscribers than for voice subscribers in our service area. Some programming contracts require the MVPD to add channels that may be acquired or may be added through the course of the contract term. This creates additional work for the service provider to make the provisions necessary for additional carriage, and eventually it results in additional cost for the viewer. I keep saying cost a lot. It's a big piece of this. While we have tried to negotiate for the exclusion of this type of language, we haven't been successful in those efforts. Even more troubling is that the channel and its content can be changed mid-term, and we are not allowed to drop that channel. A recent example of this practice has led to numerous customer complaints and demands to have this new channel removed from our television lineup because the programming contract language allowing this type of change from their decision, we are unable to drop the channel that is considered highly offensive to a large portion of my customer base. As more content providers are allowing TV everywhere options, we have seen more regularly that this feature now comes at a cost, regardless of whether the television subscriber uses or even wants to use the service. The fee is assessed against an entire subscriber base and has become another mechanism for programmers to raise the rates associated with their content. Observing our customer base, many of our younger people are finding online content from many sources. They're happy to view their video content in this matter. However, a larger percentage of our customers prefer to watch video programming in a more traditional manner. But with additional fees for TV everywhere, traditional viewers are essentially paying extra for more content that's online. I appreciate the opportunity to participate in this workshop on behalf of my company and our customers. I look forward to the questions through the remainder of the day. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you to all our panelists. We are now opening up to questions. As Bill mentioned, there's two ways. You can write down a question on a card and it can be passed to me. And there will also be microphones passed throughout the audience if anyone has questions. think we have.
Yes, hello. Oh, sorry. Thank you all very much. I'm wondering about the, my impression is that most of you have spoken a lot about the problems with forced bundling, and I was wondering what you might have to say about some of the other sort of contract practices, such as MFNs and ADMs that have been raised as problems. I'd like to have your insight on what those kind of, what problems might come from those as well.
Thank you. Does anyone want to take the lead on that?
Sure, I'll start, and if you want to jump in. I do think that we do encounter significant issues with MFNs. In the realm of independent programmers, and again, I'm speaking of not the large programmers, but we do hear very consistently from them that because of the MFNs that they do have in their deals with the larger MVPDs, they aren't able to give us some of the flexibility that we require because our members are smaller, they're not necessarily as advanced, their platforms aren't as advanced, and we do need flexibility. And we do hear very consistently that those MFNs prevent them from being able to give us some of that flexibility. And so it is absolutely a problem for us meaning the NCTC, in negotiating programming deals with smaller independent programmers who have already engaged and already agreed to deals with some of the larger MVPDs.
Anyone else have a comment?
Sure, I'll take a shot at it. So I see the MFNs on both the retrans side, working with Judy and some other independents we do on the national network side. The MFN, it is a nebulous, it is a black box term when we see it brought up when they don't want to negotiate anymore. And we have a rate request or a term request. They will simply say, that would contradict another MFN that we've got, end of discussion. So I think these MFNs, as it relates to a smaller provider, do a great deal of harm that is passed directly on to consumers.
If I might also follow up, does anyone have any comments on the ADM clauses?
I think the ADMs are a little bit different. I think the ADMs maybe at one point were more restrictive and could have caused more probably harm. I think at this point now, I think most of the ADMs out there are really more protecting the operator from devaluing what they are now paying for and distributing to their consumers. So I guess in my experience, I would not say that the ADMs are probably cause as many problems as the MFNs in terms of negotiating deals with independent programmers. I don't know if you've had the same experiences.
The only thing I might add is again, when we first started seeing that, there weren't necessarily costs associated with the alternate distribution methods. But as time goes, we are beginning to hear, see more of that as a practice. So that's another concern as we look at the cost to the end user consumer.
Okay. I guess I would just add that we've talked about MFNs as it relates to the smaller independent programmers. When it comes to the larger negotiations that I've handled directly, there is absolutely no tolerance for offering an MFN or a comparable market term from the larger programming groups. So they're just simply not available. And when you ask for some level of protection, would you be willing to represent that in a contract, the answer is, we don't do MFNs. Well, they don't do MFNs for folks our size. But it's an interesting dynamic, the very thing that prevents us from being able to broaden distribution for some of the independent programmers because of MFNs, we actually can't take advantage of for beneficial terms on our own.
So if I could jump in one more time. So we often ask for the MFNs, never given to us. They're always used against us. On the alternative distribution methods, ESPN3 is a good example. We pay on all of our broadband customers. It is a network that has changed drastically from we were one of the first ones to launch it. And it is very concerning
to us for that business model, and we have not been able to change the economics with ESPN3.
Okay, thank you. I think Jonathan Levy has a question. He's our acting chief economist.
Hi, I wanted to ask a little bit more about the capacity constraints. And in particular, is there anything you can say about how you divide your capacity up between video and broadband, and you know, how much is for broadband? How has that been growing over time? Thank you.
I can take a stab at talking to the rate of growth that broadband demands. So we've, you know, more than quadrupled the amount of bandwidth allocated to broadband over the last 2 years. We used to allocate, you know, 1 or 2 6 megahertz channels in a, you know, 750 megahertz system. We now allocate, you know, if we want to go to DOCSIS 3.1, 32 channels. So it's an incredibly fast-paced growth that we are challenged to keep up with, and at the same time challenged to meet the growing bandwidth demands of quite frankly, analog video. Digital video still puts demands on the system as well, but analog is the main offender.
So our data utilization has more than doubled over the past 3 years, and we see that as a factor that our existing customers are more intensively using our internet capacity for things like Netflix, and we're also increasing our internet customers. To be clear, and I didn't say this in our opening remarks, we have more internet subs than we do video subs today, which is a big deal, a big difference than where we thought we'd be today and where it was 10 years ago. But we built our network to ensure that we're going to have the best internet experience that we have. One of the challenges that we have to work around is we have these channels that are out there, and once, as part of these negotiations and these contracts, and once they're out there, they don't come off and you can't move them. And so that is a big problem for us. You have this set, you know, box of video channel capacity to work around that, and that's continuing to increase as more channels are melted down into the expanded basic lineup, and that's a very nice way that has very negative implications to our network. As video is there and growing, and internet, you know, the curve for internet is more than doubling.
Can I ask each questioner to identify themselves?
Hi, I'm Dan Cachado. I'm with a channel called Cinema. You've all reflected the owner's practice of forcing many, many channels, even mystery channels that don't have any definition. Is it a fair consideration? The question is, why? Why do these big programmers do that? Is one fair consideration that they do it to squash competition? By them taking all the channel space, they keep their competitors away. And, of course, it squashes diversity in the type of programming, because most of their programming is from the same shelf.
Well, I guess I can't. I mean, I'm not in their head, so I'm not sure that I've ever seen, you know, an agenda written out that that's their goal. Certainly, in the end, that is some of the result. I do believe that is what ends up happening, is that because they are forcing us to carry so many of the channels, it does kind of edge out any other opportunity or very many opportunities for other independent programmers to get on that channel lineup. And in the end, it flows through, and I do believe that it does harm the consumer because they do end up paying more for services that they may not even have any desire for. So, I think that would be my answer.
I think it's important to also make the distinction that while there are diverse networks that the larger programming groups own, they're not necessarily the networks that are best suited or would have been our top choice in our particular markets. So if I look at a market like Miami, just because a certain company that normally does kids and sports put out a bilingual news network, that is not necessarily the best channel to serve my customer base there. You know, something featuring Cuban baseball would be better suited in that market. But a lot of times, the larger programming groups become the gatekeepers of diversity by default. So.
I could take one shot at it. I think it's very, I can't speak for the programmers, but I'll give you two examples, and I think both of them kind of hinge on market power. So with AMC, we were forced to drop AMC at year end. We wanted to keep those channels on where we were currently carrying them. That was not an option we were going to be given. They were going to force or melt all of those channels down into expanded basic. We had set-top box data. Our customers were not asking for those channels to come down. It would have been a significant price increase to our consumers. And so we were very open with them. Let us leave these channels on where they are. But if you don't, we're going to have to, you know, to drop us. And that was it. That is how it went. Now I'm speculating. I think, you know, AMC had some objectives that have been speculated in the press about why they want those channels, more channels on and more down in expanded basic. So, you know, I think the other side of it, outside of AMC, for the larger programmers, I think that there is a very clear recognition. Once they have that real estate, if you want to call these real estate, they will have it forever, regardless of how they want to use it.
Jimmy, did you want to add anything?
No, I would echo exactly what's been said. My wife told me a long time ago, I'm not good at reading minds, so I can only assume that your ideas about possibly limiting the competition or such might be the reason. I can't prove that, but what I do know is that when it comes down to the requirements to carry these additional channels, it does make a difference in what we can offer beyond that. And quite frankly, our customers, again, want a good product for a reasonable cost, and it's making that prohibitive.
Okay. Do you have a question?
Yes. Excuse me. Yes, my name is Charles Herring. I'm with One American News Network and AWE. I have a question on what is an independent network in your mind. Ms. Mica, I think you mentioned you have 20-plus years of experience. You represent over 850 independent networks, yet these large programmers that have multiple services you don't view as an independent. And perhaps maybe you don't view an independent as a programmer that has association with a broadcaster. Based on your experience, what would you consider to be an independent? And approximately how many do you think are really in the marketplace?
Oh, I'm not sure if I can answer the last question, but the prior question, as I said or as I mentioned earlier, I mean, we really, regardless of whether it's vertically integrated or not, I think that we, when we're negotiating agreements and when we're dealing with our 850 members, we really address the large programmers, given the fact that they're of their size, the number of channels that they have, the amount of leverage that they have in the negotiations with us. I guess it's very difficult to think of them as independent programmers. So it's really, other than those large nine, you could maybe say there's 10. It depends on how you want to define it. But for us, our largest, our nine deals with our largest programming providers, they account for a significant number of the total channels that our members carry, and they also account for a significant amount of the cost that all of our members have to pay for programming fees. So we really, when I'm sitting up here and talking about it today, for independent programmers, I'm really referring to other than those nine large programmers. As far as how many independent programmers exist, a lot. I guess I wouldn't be able to, sitting here right now, be able to give you an exact number, but there's a significant amount of independent programmers out there.
Actually, I'm glad you asked that question because, just for way of background, in our programming NOI, we proposed a definition of independent, which was we didn't want to include those programmers that were vertically integrated. And I think what this discussion is showing, that maybe we need to fine-tune our definition of independent programming. So I definitely would be interested in any thoughts you had. You mentioned size, Judy. I don't know if there's a certain cutoff, or is it a size in terms of the amount of other programming and other channels that they own, including maybe some considered must-have programming. I don't know if you guys have any thoughts on that, but that would certainly be something that we'd be interested in hearing about.
I would. I mean, it would take a little bit more work, but I think that earlier what was presented and having to do with, you know, the ownership of certain number of top 50 networks or and the must-have programming, I think there are probably ways that you could define it and define it a little closer to how our kind of what our interaction is with the programmers.
Did anyone else have any thoughts on that before we move on?
I would just say, you know, so by, you know, by way of comparison, you know, I get mailings of new networks every week. So very easy to classify an independent programmer as somebody who's just emerged in the marketplace. But there are some independents like Hallmark that have been around for a long time that have proven their, you know, their value in ratings and performance and have not exploited the system in the way that others have. So I would just make that point.
Okay. Do you have a question, sir?
Yes, please. Craig Morris, Rad TV. I know we're discussing the plight of independent MVPDs as well as independent programmers here and smaller versions of that. One of the things that we focused on is the fact that if we get rid of bundling, that should help alleviate some of the problems. All of you have mentioned the fact that you would launch some more smaller independent networks if we could get rid of bundling. I don't know if just getting rid of bundling will actually alleviate the problem. I'd like to hear your thoughts on this, because we know that those 9 big conglomerates that you talk about, when they come in, even if you're not forced to carry those other ones, if they can't bundle them together, they can still come in and say, I'll let you have ESPN at 15 cents instead of 25 cents if you'll carry these other 2 channels with it. It may not be written in the contract. You may not be forced to do it, but it's still a negotiating tactic. So how, from an independent MVPD, smaller, and an independent channel, how are we going to get around that part of the negotiation side with the 900-pound gorilla in the room who's got all the cards?
Can I find out where you're buying ESPN for 15 cents?
It was definitely just a metaphor on that. Yeah.
I went back to the slide that only went to 2007 on independent network.
Does anyone want to take a stab at that? Go ahead, Duke.
Yeah, I think capacity issues aside, one of the biggest issues is that there's such a broad, diverse desire for content out there, and every individual's tastes are different. I'm a proponent of the idea of genre-based packaging that allows people choices. If they want to pay the $200 a month for the whole mix, that's fine. If they're looking for something in a $50 range, that's fine. What we tend to see with regard to a lot of the programming that's out there, sports is absolutely one of the biggest cost drivers out there, and it never stops. It gets worse every year. We also see cable news as being an area where costs have been increasing significantly. That leaves an awful lot of other content out there that people are interested in and watch, and we've seen the ratings numbers that don't necessarily need to be bundled along with those services. Now, what would that do to the price of a sports package if it were unbundled? I guess the market would determine that. But as I've mentioned, I really believe that that is a great way to move forward in trying to provide choice to consumers.
And I agree with that. I just don't think that still addresses the issue of how do you get past that negotiating tactic and the person who holds all the cards. If we're going to look at this from what's good for you and what's good for a smaller independent programmer, I think I don't think that solves the issue. Would any of you be opposed to a provision being put in that says if you launch 2 networks that are from the big 9, that you're required to launch 1 small network along with that? Is there some sort of provision in that you'd be willing to go for? Because to me, that's the only way it seems possible for us to be on an equal playing field with the guys who hold all the chips.
I think that's tough because then, first of all, it becomes very complex. But second of all, again, you're almost allowing there to be carriage that, frankly, may not be deserved. I mean, nobody should get a free ride. You should actually produce quality programming that consumers, you know, want and are willing to pay for. So I don't have all of the answers. I do think that when you combined the bundling with, you know, the forced penetration guarantees, you really are you aren't right pricing those networks. If an operator were allowed to pass through to its customers and say, if you want these sports networks, you may have to pay a lot more for them, but you don't have to pay for them if you don't want them. And so maybe it does create a right price if, in fact, the programmer has to price it for the marketplace. So it could certainly help to at least open some of the doors. I would hesitate to just say that there's a free ride, frankly, for anybody. I think, you know, you have to earn your way into the consumer's heart.
Yeah, the only trick with that is until you're actually available and people can see you, there's no real way to measure that.
That's correct.
For us, that's the big if, you know, and that seems to be a lot of the a lot of what goes on in that negotiation. It's sort of the unspoken rule is that as long as nobody launches you, nobody has to. And, you know, from that standpoint, it's for us, it's a very unfair trade practice, and it's something that that the MFNs just accentuate, absolutely, because your best deal is your worst deal.
I wanted to ask a question about bundling. So I think it was a common theme, and we've been talking about it just now, about you all mentioned forced bundling, but I wanted to talk about just bundling practices. Because as Tasneem mentioned, there's with some of these practices like MFNs, there's pro-competitive reasons for some of these practices. Bundling could be pro-competitive. It could benefit consumers in some situations. Could you all elaborate under what circumstances you embrace bundles and you think those would serve your subscribers as opposed to those situations in which they wouldn't? Is it really just a very case-specific situation?
Do you want me to? I think I will let our operators speak more to the, you know, the bundling on a retail level to the consumer. I think on the wholesale level, you know, the programmers bundling to us, I think, does create and causes more harm to the consumer, frankly, than it does benefit. I know that the programmers will argue that there's cost benefits to being able to bundle, and I have to say that in reality, that's just not what we see. We are never given the option. We are never given the option of actually taking a non-bundled group of services. It's pretty much the way that they negotiate and the way that they present it to us without a lot of alternatives. And so we do believe that that then flows through and actually does harm the consumer because the consumer is forced to pay for programming services that they may not watch, they may not be interested in, they may not have any desire for. I think on the, you know, on bundling services together, such as, you know, broadband with telephone and with video, I think that's more of a consumer issue that actually presents to them, you know, some benefits of being able to get all of those services in one. But yeah. I would let you speak to that.
Well, I would just say, and we may have a different perspective as an MVPD than some of the other smaller providers, but we are still a proponent of offering video packages. What we're looking for is some level of flexibility so that we can offer choice. I think what we're trying to say today is that there's a big fat expanded basic, there's actually a big fat digital basic, and there's really not much else. There's really not more room for the consumer to make a price or content choice from the packages they buy from us. We want to remain in the video business, but in order to do that, we have to remain relevant, you know, to our customers and create that choice. It's one of the reasons why we've integrated things like Netflix on the set-top box. We're trying to innovate in a marketplace that really doesn't permit that based on the incumbent deals.
I'll take a shot. Starting first with your product question, certainly we offer voice, video, data bundles, but we also allow consumers to purchase them individually. The consumer can create their own bundle as much or as little as they want. So on the video side, so bundling for us on the video side is a big problem. And so I guess you started with the question of, is there a benefit? I can say emphatically today, we don't see one. We have systems where we have five available channels that we've already spent money to upgrade. They are 1 gigahertz systems. We thought that would be plenty. Those 5 channels, you know, will be used for internet capacity today. And that's where we see the greater demand and the greater consumer benefit going versus these channels, whether they're to be named later or whatever they may be. I can tell you these channels, whether the rate or the carriage, they have nothing to do with quality or Nielsen ratings, things like that, or what our consumers are asking for. And so this bundling, we're in a state now that bundling on the video side, we view it as a negative. Our consumers view it as a negative. We are seeing every bit of $5 a year rate increases for just the video side. And so we are fighting very hard. What is the process? When we dropped AMC, we pushed people to go find that AMC programming on Amazon Prime. We want that to happen. That is a more efficient distribution market when a fraction of your customers are watching your video content than using a channel across all of your systems to service something that you may get less than 10% or 5% of your customers are looking at.
And how often did you want something you wanted to add to that, Duke?
Yeah, this last retransmission consent go around saw something a little bit disturbing there in that it was a direct negotiation, as all of our retrans agreements are, and was put in a position of having to bring on a new national channel, one that we had carried at one time but had since dropped. And because of their ownership and their desire to get the carriage for that channel, I asked specifically for rates on the two separately. And suffice it to say that the rate for the retrans consent came out so high as to be absurd, and when bundled, was significantly lower. I mean, there was no choice there. It was strictly a leveraging tactic used to get carriage on a new business enterprise for this operation.
And that ties very closely to what was said earlier. You know, I think if you go back a decade or 15 years back, the bundling probably was beneficial, but you added, those channels were added, and there was a very little or no cost to that. So it added diversity and what was there. Fast forward to what we've seen in the past 5 years, the costs have grown. They're no longer able to be in specialty tiers. They all are in the super expanded basic package, which means that every consumer is paying a much higher amount for that, you know, content they want to see because of the fact that now they have to have all of these channels on the basic, and they're paying significantly higher prices than the way it was introduced. They sneak it in the door, they get it on there, and they continue to raise the prices annually.
And how often have you had to actually drop an independent programmer or reduce the amount of your capacity dedicated to broadband because of having to carry these bundled offerings? Is that common, or what happens?
Yeah, I mean, there's obviously an evaluation that takes place, you know, based on the network performance and how our viewers value it, and the cost of continuing carriage versus the cost of not continuing carriage. By and large, our only options are with independent programmers, because the larger must-have content just doesn't allow for lesser distribution of anything that's already carried. And as far as the bandwidth allocation, I talked to the growth rate of high-speed internet demand on capacity. And, you know, we have, I run a technical call every other week where we slice and dice the obligations on a, you know, 900-line Excel spreadsheet that we operate from, and it's, you know, it's a question of how are we going to make this happen, and more often than not, we're band-aiding. We're investing $600,000 to buy 75 megahertz of space, half of which should really go to high-speed internet, but it can't because we're required, you know, to add more video. So it's an ongoing daily, you know, challenge, and if we're going to evolve into an MPEG-4 or IP platform where we really can do what's required of us on all fronts, we're going to have to see some change.
You know, if you look back when we first got into the video business, it was more on the coax platform, And we could see back in the 90s that the demand for broadband and the amount of capacity needed for video was going to continue to raise. You know, Duke talked about MPEG-2, and then, you know, you've had other technologies that, which has compressed the bandwidth necessary, but it continues to grow. And so we've spent over a couple hundred million dollars in building a fiber infrastructure to basically overcome that capacity issue. But quite frankly, that is a huge expense that many, you know, small providers cannot handle. So, you know, we did that knowing that broadband will continue to be the future. Video is also very important to our subscribers, but that whole market dynamic is changing and is becoming less appealing for our customers due to the things we're discussing here today.
Okay. Thank you. I think we have a question over here.
It's actually more of a comment than a question, because everybody's talking about singling out bundling. But in reality, for independent channels, I'm Daphna Edward Zyman. I'm president and chief creative officer of Cinemoi, which is an international channel, and we're distributed here by Verizon Files. We were distributed to 20 million people by DirecTV initially, but we refused to pay for play, and we took ourselves off, because I believe that the risk takers in this entire industry are the true independents, not the 150 supposed independents that are associated with the conglomerates. And in reality, it's not just bundling. It's bundling, it's vertical integration, it's taking away a seat in the advertising space from the independents. You need a minimum of 30 to 40 million households in order to gain some advertising space. And then on top of it is this pay-to-play scenario, which has become a strategy that is choking the independent. And the reality is, by doing all of that, and you are actually destroying an entire industry. I met with Myron Scholes on Thursday, who's the Nobel Prize laureate on the economy. And he said to me, this is an industry that is heading towards a disaster because it's an industry that's eating its young. And that is so true. And you look at what you call independents, who are not really independents, and the fact that there's only two women owners of a television network in this country is a disgrace. It's myself and Oprah, and she's owned 50% by Discovery. To remain independent, we had to fight not to be associated or bought by a conglomerate. And to remain an independent, I have so much respect for small MVPDs that are trying to overcome some of the obstacles. But I believe sincerely that everybody needs to have FCC intervention, because number one, when you launch a channel, it should be based on market research. It should be based on proving quality, on proving track record. It is not merely the fact that somebody is shoving some programming down your throat. It's like telling somebody, oh, you want to see this blockbuster movie, I'm forcing you to go and see three other movies that are not selling so you can see the one. This is oligopoly. This is not an industry that can grow unless you have people behind it who are willing to fight the fight and have big pockets enough to survive. The independents cannot survive with OTT alone, because they need exposure, without advertisers, by paying to play, with vertical integration and bundles. It is impossible. It's a one-way ticket to bankruptcy, not only of the independents, but of the entire industry, because innovation is synonymous with independents who are the risk takers. I don't know if you have any comments.
Thank you,
well,
Daphne.
I guess I could try to take a shot at the bridge, the capacity question, and the end of it with yours. And so we want to offer these smaller bundles, these slimmer bundles. And I think one of the keys to your comment, and I would be interested to hear everyone's comments on that, but the slimmer bundle is so important to us for the economics of our end users, the affordability part of it, the capacity on our network. But as you've heard earlier, we can't, because there's been some market power exerted in these contracts that have these, if you want to call them rate floors or collars, whatever you want to call them, that are preventing it. And I'm not sure the right path forward, but it is those artificial free market interventions, if you want to call it that, that are preventing this, the smaller bundles right now. And the smaller bundles, slimmer bundles, whatever you want to call them, that would allow that some of this cord shaving would allow us to do exactly what you're asking.
Yeah, I would agree with that. I mean, I think the consumers, I don't think consumers are saying they want less content. I think they're saying they want more cost efficient or cost effective or lower cost options. And I firmly believe that our members, because of the agreements that we have in place, and most notably those with the large programmers, they're prevented from reacting to the consumer demands because there are requirements in those agreements that really prevent them from putting together these smaller packages that can be then sold at a lower price point.
Anyone else have a comment before we go to the next question? Okay.
Yes, I just was wondering if you all had any thoughts about, just because I know you all are relatively small MVPDs, do you have any, about any problems or challenges about, the over-the-top, if you face special challenges, with the over-the-top, innovation like Netflix and so forth?
We've seen that our data utilization has become largely a video distribution platform. These days, you don't see that nearly as much of the emailing and the website browsing that you did in the past. Today, it's you build your network capacities to supply consumer demand in the peak hours because the content is being streamed. It's a constant flow of data. It raises the cost of building our networks and maintaining them, constantly adding capacity because as more and more consumers drift to the over-the-top model, is just like a nonstop pressure. So that requires us to build our networks to that capacity, which means that we're taking the monies that we're developing and trying to keep them towards innovation and an expansion of our capacity. We embrace over-the-top. We'd be foolish not to. Our consumers really want to use those services, and there is a lot of room for innovation with over-the-top in terms of new content availability and that type of thing. The problem we're having is that we still have a large customer base that really wants bundled packages and likes the convenience and are accustomed to using those services the way they've been for years. Problem is the margins are getting squeezed to the point where, from a competitive standpoint, we don't have the money to continue the innovation we'd like to continue to bring more capacity to those subscribers. So there's a constant squeeze going on that. It's true that the bandwidth margins are pretty good. How long they'll stay that way, I don't know. But I can say that our costs of delivering that bandwidth are increasing substantially all the time. I think there isn't anybody here that wouldn't love to be in Jimmy's position where they've got a fiber-to-the-home network, but I also know that didn't come cheap.
What's your name? Who are you?
I'm George Williams. I work in the Media Bureau.
Oh, great. Nice to meet you. We embrace companies like Netflix. We were actually the first MVPD to launch Netflix on the TiVo, integrated TiVo set-top box, not the direct-to-consumer TiVo set-top box, but we've partnered significantly with TiVo to bring an enhanced, ubiquitous video experience to our customers. And it's generally additive. That's how we see it. There are some cases, so there's bound to be some aggregation in the OTT world at some point. We've yet to see how that will play out,
But, you know, I think one interesting point is that some direct-to-consumer offerings from the programmers are actually priced more aggressively directly to the consumer than they are priced wholesale to us. Mm-hmm. And so talk about anti-competitive. We are basically handing over our customers at a fraction of the margin for the programmer. So this is, you know, serving no one's best interest, and yet it's continuing to happen. And the position that the programmers take generally is, well, that's not really, you know, it's a different customer. It's not your customer. It's a customer that would never have subscribed to cable traditionally. And I just don't buy that. And it is incredibly challenging to do a deal in an environment where that is the case. You can't rationalize in your head paying a license fee that's higher than a direct to consumer price point.
So Shintel, we embrace over the top. You know, we've built a network that we believe is going to be key to that strategy for us to be the best internet provider in the markets we serve. We embrace Netflix. We have their server co-located in our data center to improve the user's experience. A year ago, we're not a TiVo shop. We're an Aeris box shop. We launched the new Aeris Whole Home Gateway boxes. Those cost us roughly $400. We've got about 3,000 of them deployed. They have app capabilities. They've been out for a year. We still don't have the apps deployed on them because it is has been a very slow process to get Hulu engaged, Pandora engaged. Netflix has been unresponsive on this. And so this is an example that I would point to. We are putting our money up out in front, and the technology is there today, but it has been very hard to get the attention of Silicon Valley to enable these applications that are already available to almost everybody else except rural America.
One of the things that I had noted earlier was that we saw a higher percentage of cord cutters, if you will, for video this past year. And we launched an over-the-top for local broadcast. And the way it works is it's still on our managed network. It has to be on our fiber distribution platform in order for them to get that local content. But it's, you know, one way that we're having to adapt to be able to provide video in the manner that some of our customers are now seeking it. So that's just, you know, it is something that, like it or not, OTT is a disruptor in this ecosystem, and we will have to learn how to adjust with it.
And just one quick follow-up question on that. Do you think it's going to be easier for your customers to find the type of content that they would like to watch using the OTT platforms, having you as the broadband provider and then being able to access more diverse content or more individualized content through the internet?
I don't know if it'll be easier, but I mean, with the technology that's out there today, you know, you can go online and you can search where to find content, you know, anywhere. But a lot of our demographics, you know, an older population in northwestern, north central Kansas, they want the ease of being able to look at a guide and simplifying it that way. Our younger people, they can find it on their phone, they can find it on the iPad, their computer, whatever device. And that's just normal for how they look for video. They spend more time looking at non-traditional video than they do what we consider traditional video. But is it easier? I think it depends on your age. And I hate to say that. Well, maybe not age, but your tech savviness. Because I guess I'm no longer young. I'm kind of getting old now. But, you know, I learned from my kids ways to find content, and you know, we leverage that in our discussions on how we're going to address that in the office.
Heather?
It just brings up an interesting point, because we've talked a lot about sort of the onerous cost and bandwidth pressure that bundling puts on, but you know, we haven't talked about some of the other deal terms that are just as important for us. And so in a lot of cases in the OTT world, from the directly from the programmer, That content is advantaged on the programmers' websites. So they will not provide to us the deep links or assets that are required for our customers to find it, let's say through an Atlantic Broadband portal, the same way that they would allow it on their direct-to-consumer site. So by default, it's being advantaged, and so that's something that has to be addressed. If we should have parity. If we're paying for this content and paying for the TV Everywhere rights, we should have parity. When our customers go to the Atlantic Broadband portal and try to pull up a specific episode and get redirected to a programmer's website and have to do an entire login and credential verification again, it's an incredibly frustrating experience, and we just want to provide a ubiquitous experience across all platforms so that customers can find the content that they want as quickly as they want to find it.
All right. Go ahead.
You have a question regarding the incentives for large MVPDs to launch their own programming services. In your experience and what you've seen through the years in the industry, do they have the incentive to launch their own channels so they can trade and set wholesale rates in the marketplace with other MVPDs? And would a large MVPD maybe even be at a disadvantage if they didn't have programming holdings where they can trade when they're doing deals with, say, other large MVPDs that may have regional sports networks or other types of programming? In other words, in addition to maybe providing a benefit to their customer while they're consuming assets, bandwidth, are there other incentives for large MVPDs to launch their own affiliated programming? Thank you.
I'm not sure the question. Do you mean on an OTT basis?
No, MVPD, traditional basis.
And you're asking, are there any other incentives from the consumer perspective or from
the MVPD perspective to launch their own affiliated program?
I'm assuming they launch some of their other networks because they make money off of them, and they have other outlets then for their content.
But is the lack of ability to trade when they're doing programming deals, if a large MVPD does not have programming holdings, a disadvantage to them from a business standpoint?
Not being a large MVPD, I really can't say directly that I can know what their thoughts are, but I think you're referring to like a Comcast where they provide service to a geographic area, but they also own content. And I would say that it probably does put them in a driver's seat because, you know, it was discussed earlier where as smaller providers, the cost for programming is higher than it is for what we know, like some of the larger providers are paying. So, you know, I would say that it probably is an incentive, but I can't say this because I've got any data supporting that.
I was just going to say, given that most of our members are smaller, I don't think that there even exists the opportunity, actually, for them, most of them, to do that. It really has to be the large MVPDs that you're talking about.
I was just, in thinking through the question, I think you're asking, like, what other advantages exist for large MVPDs to own programming, and what came to mind is their ability to cross-promote, you know, and so... a large MVPD can own content. They can promote it on the MVPD's cross-channel inventory. They can also leverage broadcast and cable channels to promote programs and channels and create demand through those properties. So it is sort of inherently advantaged.
And I think the last question for this session will go to Jonathan Levy.
Yeah, I wanted to get back to the possible relationship between costs and what you refer to as forced bundling. So suppose in addressing this issue in the discussion, a few of you sort of implied that in the absence of bundling, the prices would go up substantially for the particularly popular programming. So let's just assume that there isn't, it's not possible to bundle at the wholesale level. Would you be okay with sort of unregulated prices for the very, very popular programming. And the second and last part of the question is, you also mentioned penetration requirements. So if wholesale bundling were eliminated, would you still want or advocate or feel you needed some sort of intervention with regard to the pricing of marquee programming and to penetration requirements? Thanks.
I would say with regards to if it were to be unbundled, the penetration considerations would also need to be dropped, because then again, if they break up the package of channels, but then they increase the cost for each of those, and then we still have to carry them on our most widely viewed package, well, I mean, intuitively, the cost for providing that service is going to go up to our consumers. And so it has to kind of be looked at in both ways. If you allow the breakup but don't, you know, remove the requirement to carry it on that, you know, super basic bundle or package, then it really defeats the purpose.
Yeah, I would just echo that. I mean, the bundling and the penetration guarantees kind of work together to really raise the cost to the consumer. So it'd be difficult to alleviate one without alleviating the other to actually fix any of the issue. I think that, frankly, if you're not guaranteed absolute carriage to an absolute number of subscribers, I would hope that in the end that means you actually would have to right price your network, because if you outprice yourself for the market, nobody's going to carry you. But if you price yourself right and you actually can then be priced right to the consumer, it should actually be a benefit for everyone for consuming video, because then they're going to be paying for what they actually want to be viewing.
Could I take a shot at something we haven't talked a lot about, but I think your question gets at, and it's on the retrans side, though, and there was a very dramatic case of bundling that I experienced in the last retrans cycle. So to get access to an ABC network, we had to agree to carry a cable network that didn't exist, that wouldn't be defined in this contract, to bundle it. At some point in the future when they figured out when it was going to exist. And I can tell you, we pushed back very hard. They told us where we were going to put it and basically when we were going to put it in this contract, or there would be no contract, all right? And we pushed back very hard. That contract provision, the other painful thing is it just wasn't in the retrans market where we had those stations for that. It went across all of our cable networks. And I cannot describe the level of anger that we had with, we'll call this a land grab, by a very, very large, powerfully financed New York, you know, it's a publicly traded company, against us with our limited number of customers. It is a stark, I think, representation of market power, and I think that's part of what we're getting at, and it's a stark representation of where bundling is going. To take one little lever that you might have for, you know, part of a market and leverage that over an entire country, if you want to call that, for a system, for a channel that no one's asking for, that doesn't exist. They've since gone out and bought a channel because they had a placeholder for this thing. I mean, so there is an example of bundling where I think that I'm not a regulator, but I would plead that small companies and consumers are need your help.
Can I just follow up? Is that practice that you mentioned were prohibited? Do you think that the standalone rate for retransmission consent for that channel would have been higher?
It may have been. It is hard for me to peg retransmission consent rates and maybe where they're going. I will add to that, rates are consistently higher when these consolidators buy up, will have an existing retrans rate that will be half of a rate, and the day after they acquire a local ABC, NBC, it will basically double into their rate. I think that this to-be-named channel represented probably 30% of the overall retrans rate. The bigger issue to me, let me frame it this way, if we could have maybe isolated it to just where we were carrying that retrans station versus we're paying that rate across for all of our subs, all 60,000, 58,000. And so the rate may have been more expensive, but I think in total it would have been less because it could have just been isolated to the markets where we had the retrans. And that would have been a win-win for consumers and for Shentel.
Can I just add to that very quickly? I think one of the biggest issues we deal with is that the content providers and the consumer are shielded in this process. There's really no relationship. The customer has no idea what they're paying for what content they're getting. There's no real truth in billing when it comes to this. There's one bundled price. All the channels are tossed together. Customer doesn't know if they actually feel that they're getting the value for their dollar. So that lack of information and that position that we play as the middleman through this puts us in a really tough spot. It truly does. We get all the heat. The content providers say, hey, customers like our stuff. See, here's the ratings. And it's a very difficult position to be in.
Heather, did you want to add something?
Oh, I want to add a lot of stuff. It's been well stated.
Okay. Well, I wanted to thank all of our panelists for participating today. We're going to be having another panel at 1 o'clock with independent programmers. So please come back. Thank you very much.
Welcome back, everyone. We'll get started with our second panel on the subject of challenges faced by independent programmers when they seek carriage on video distribution platforms. We're delighted to have a wonderful panel of experts on the subject. Starting from my left, Brian Newton, Creative Director and Head of New Media for the Africa Channel. Eric Easter, Chief Executive Officer, Black Box Digital. Daphna Zeiman, President and Creative Director, Cinemoa. Clifford Franklin, Chief Executive Officer, GFN-TV. Patrick Gotch, Founder and President, RFD-TV. And Craig Morris, President of Ride Television Network. We'll start with Mr. Newton. Welcome.
There you go. Great. Good afternoon, everyone, and I'd like to thank the FCC for having us here today. The Africa Channel is an African-American targeted program distributed currently by Time Warner and Comcast that focuses on travel, lifestyle, and cultural programming. Our audience is upscale, aspirational, the global citizen, people who have a high sense of the global community in the world, and then also African expats that are sprinkled throughout the U.S. Our place in the world, our focus at the Africa Channel has been bridging the gap between traditional lifestyle programming formats and African-American audiences. If you look at the slide placed on the screen, on your right-hand side, you have primarily African-American targeted networks. But when you look at their programming grid and their content offering, there's a lot of redundancy. There isn't much diversity in the programming, a lot of reality TVs, old movies. But on the left-hand side, where you look at many of the Scripps networks, you see programming that's lifestyle in nature, but it doesn't service an audience of color, if you will. There's extreme lack of diversity in terms of talent hosts, talent featured in that programming, yet African Americans make a significant portion of their viewership. What I'm just going to show you briefly is just kind of a quick promo just to give you a sample of the reel, and we'll set up just kind of our dialogue for today.
The
Africa Channel presents
all new family-friendly shows.
Superstars!
More dramas.
Every second makes a difference.
I know who the murderer is.
These are beautiful, absolutely amazing.
Fun new chefs and fabulous foods.
I'm going to take you on a culinary adventure of this vibrant country.
Bookers and join here again. We're on the hunt for the great food.
And our all-new Nollywood Night.
Ayo is going to propose.
When are we coming to your wedding?
New locales and luxurious lifestyles.
We pinpoint Africa's most intriguing entrepreneurs around the globe.
Enjoy original shows and exciting new episodes of your favorites.
Wait for it. I can drink this all day.
An all-new entertainment experience.
This meat is extremely sweet.
Another of the big seven.
Beginning April 18th.
This was going to be the night.
On the Africa Channel.
It was important for me to give an introduction to our brand because I think just looking at the content being displayed, you could see how this could live just about anywhere on the dial. But the truth of the matter is we've had extreme challenges in terms of gaining distribution within Comcast and Time Warner, who we're currently distributed with, to approximately about 10 million households. The only challenge with that amount of distribution is the fact that our sole revenue driver at this point is attached to subscriber fees. And the MFNs are extremely prohibitive in the fact that it doesn't allow us to talk to other MVPDs for like this, for instance, and negotiate periods of free carriage or lower subscriber fee license fees that we currently have with our existing operators. And that proves challenging for us because from the business perspective, I can understand the pushback. Someone like Dish, for instance, with a footprint of 13 million households, to negotiate, how do you justify paying $15 million to launch a network that no one has ever heard of prior? So MFNs are extremely prohibitive for us in that regard because it doesn't allow us the ability to negotiate. It doesn't allow us the ability to offer free carriage, periods of proof of concept. And this has been extremely prohibitive as a result of our distribution. The other crippling element that I'd like for us to address today would be around ADM language. As it states currently, the Africa Channel's ADM language prohibits us to only distributing a maximum of 10 minutes of content on any additional platform, period. So this precludes us from taking advantage of any of the existing value-added service products, for instance, like TVE, which we are technologically capable of delivering but are unable to as a result of our ADM language. So I come before the FCC and guests here today to ask that there's a stand that be taken against MFNs as well as ADM language and any agreements for independent operators under a particular threshold. I think we can all agree that anything less than 20 million to 25 million households in linear in this business is impossible to operate as an independent organization. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Easter.
Hi, I'm Eric Easter. I'm the founder of Black Box, which is we produce original nonfiction programming that right now is developed for public media. But as the target strategy toward launch of an online streaming channel. I'm also the chairman of the National Black Programming Consortium, which for the last 35 years has developed black-focused programming for PBS. There are three other consortia for Asian American, Latinos, and Native American as well. And so I represent those as well here. It's a CPB-funded organization that develops and produces and distributes, looks for distribution for new filmmakers. Prior to that, I was the CEO of Black Heritage Network, which is one of the many independent channels who are now facing OTT distribution because they were not able to get on cable after spending, you know, many, many years of money. So a lot of folks who are in the OTT world are folks like the Black Heritage Network, who tried at one point to go cable and have pursued over-the-top as an alternative form of distribution. So I come at this issue from several angles that tend to all sort of lead to the same point about barriers to entry. But I wanted to emphasize that even as we talk about cable access or OTT access, I wanted to emphasize the need for this market at all, and the reason why some of these organizations exist to get on to OTT and to talk about the fact that there is still a market that is not being met, a need for diverse content that's not being met, and that's the reason why these folks exist, because I think we get a bit off of that subject that, you know, once we talk about OTT and MVPDs, that we're really at the tail end of a cycle of lack of access that begins at the development of content. And that seems surprising, sorry, given the hundreds of channels that exist, that we're still talking about diverse content and a lack of content for audiences. But at the very basic level, producers of content to reach out to diverse audiences, particularly minority audiences, often still unable to ever get that content produced because they lack distribution. And the first thing that you get asked by an investor or an underwriter when you want to produce work is, where is it going to be shown? And so there's a lot of work, seriously innovative work, that never gets off of the paper that it's written on because they can't find distribution at the beginning of the process to get it made. And so that becomes a cycle where this wealth of content and all of the innovation by folks is being left out there, and then you have audiences who still have a strong desire to get new content. And for the work that does get made, the distribution ends, particularly on the PBS side where I am. If it shows once or twice on PBS, it goes into a black hole after that. If it shows on a festival, which is as far as much of the work that's done by minority creators gets, it goes into this black hole where you can no longer find it. And so the need to open up distribution networks, whether they be OTT or cable, is to begin to find channels for this wealth of content, the really thousands and thousands of hours of content that people don't think exists, but really is out there without a sufficient place to go. A lot of it is either too short to meet the demands of cable programming. It's in irregular lengths, longer than the time it needs to go on to PBS or other things. And so the OTT market becomes a new frontier, really, for makers of content and a great new opportunity for people who want to set up channels and make a place for to create an outlet for this to be for this content to show. The barriers are still significant in the OTT market, so it should not be seen as a panacea. It is a serious opportunity, but there are serious barriers for particularly minority creators who wanted to go into the market. And they include lack of capital to sustain growth while you develop audiences, the lack of standardization across devices. You create one channel, and then you have to build a new interface for another device, then a new interface for another device. And so you have to create and create and build over and over again. And you can't have engineering capacity at this level as you build audience capacity. The serious problem of placement and discoverability on program guides, that's a serious issue. Once you do get on a Roku or a Chromecast, where can you be found? How can you be found? How can you be discoverable? The cost of licenses and clearances. A lot of the content that gets made by minority filmmakers, they only have a few years of the rights for a lot of the stuff that's in their films, songs, pictures, other things. So you have to go back and relicense a lot of the work that's inside of these films. And so that becomes a huge extra cost that a lot of people don't expect when they go into the market. Problems with credit card processing requirements. New channels often face problems with not being able to charge, for example, annual subscriptions because the credit card processing folks think that you're going to go out of business, so they force you into lower monthly subscription costs. And increasingly forced payment plans, going into places like Roku and being forced to give up 20% of your business, essentially, so you can be under their payment system. It's understood because customers want an easy process of payment for new channels, but it also means you can't own your customer. And so you have new channels who cannot market to and own their list of consumers. So the FCC role going forward, I think really it's first opening up the set-top box. I mean, we haven't discussed that today, but I think that's important for discoverability of new channels. Second, to continue to look at the rulemaking that was suggested in the first panel, so we don't really get to this problem, because we need more diverse channels on cable, and small MVPDs offer those opportunities. Third, to begin to monitor the OTT market, because I really see us in 3 or 4 years, if we don't, being here having this panel over and over again, talking about how hard it is to get into the OTT market for the same reasons that it's difficult to get into cable. And so we don't get into this problem again. The FCC needs to begin seriously monitoring that market as well. Thank you.
Can I go over there?
Sure, please. Yes.
Thank you. So this says it all, actually. Media conglomerates and the television cable industry versus the cable industry. You know, I was not born in this country. It's not a speech impediment. I have an accent. I was actually born in Israel, but I grew up in Europe and Australia. And when I was growing up, one of the things, I grew up on American television like everybody else. And one of the things that was so important to me was to come to this country. My grandfather used to say to me, you must go to this country. This country is about freedom of speech, about anyone can do anything if they work hard and they put their all into it. And I believed that. And I came to this country with that belief that I was actually a part of the mecca of communication. And there was no better foreign policy in the world than American television. Nowadays, you go anywhere in the world and, oh my God, don't talk to me about American television, reality TV. The way women are projected on the screen has become something that is no longer tolerable. I was a part of a major public company, and when we sold the company to General Electric, I watched television for the first time in a long time, and I realized that I wanted to do something about it. I didn't realize that being a woman owner of a television network was not possible or not a reality. In fact, I just heard that RFD is actually owned by a woman or a couple of women. But before that, what I understood to be true is that only Oprah and I own a television network. I own Cinemoir, which is a different kind of a channel. It's a channel that shows films from vintage to modern. We took 2 years before we launched to actually do a huge market research and figure out what the public wanted. And they wanted multi-choice, multi-genre. And, of course, that's what we have. We have an international lifestyle. We have the exclusive on the Cannes Film Festival. We actually create the International Fashion Film Awards, and we've won Best Live Television in the World, just to give you an example of who we are. But I'm not just here, I'm just giving you why this is so important to me. And what I want to talk about today is something that is so serious, and people are afraid to talk about it. This entire industry is controlled by very few media giants that actually, I think I have it on the screen, I don't know. Okay. That actually, here we are, force the MVPDs to swallow many, many channels that they create in a very direct strategy of basically stealing bandwidth, stealing the financial resources, making sure that there is a pay-to-play reality, and stealing any seat in the advertising space.
Now, we know that every one of us, everyone here, every owner of an MVPD and a giant, a conglomerate, is a gatekeeper to the most important window to who we are as a country. And that holds a huge fiduciary responsibility to the public. And that cannot be interchanged with greed and lack of consciousness. The plight of video programmers is obvious when 15% at this moment of all Americans are cord cutters. And not because they prefer the small devices, but because it's in some of the programming is intolerant and some of the costs are also intolerant. It's not something that should be a reality. Just recently, Israel has passed a law about a year ago that 40% of bandwidth belongs to independents. And that is a very good thing. In 1992, you know, this country focused on 40% of the bandwidth being available to independents. But that's not the case today. As a matter of fact, my God, I can't read it. It's too small, so I'll go to my thing. In 2008, chairman of the Senate Judiciary Committee Subcommittee on Antitrust, Competition Policy, and Consumer Rights wrote, "I have long believed that it is vitally important that independent programming channels are offered to the American public rather than just programming affiliated with major cable, satellite, or broadcast television companies. Our democracy depends on the ability of independent voices to be heard, and increasing the diversity and variety of points of view available on television should be an important objective, both competition and communications policy." This really hurts all of us. It doesn't just hurt the independents, but it hurts the public, and ultimately, it even hurts the media giants, because when an industry becomes stagnant because of greed, that industry is doomed towards the death of this industry. And the spiraling demands of vertically integrated programmers, broadcasters, and sports channels restrict the opportunity for independence. And that is crucially important because independents ultimately are the ones that bring innovation into the playing field. And that creates any business, any Wall Street company, any of the Fortune 500s would tell you that if you don't keep the door open to newness and new companies with a strategy, with research, with brains, with something that is new, then that particular company is doomed. Well, this is the same in this particular situation. I believe that the FCC has a statutory obligation to intervene. Because originally what the FCC had to do is promote the public interest, convenience, and necessity by increasing competition and diversity in the multi-channel video programming market. There's a substantial governmental and First Amendment interest in promoting diversity of views. And this particular practice right now is synonymous with antitrust, especially when the cost to the consumer is rising at a very fast speed and the cost is higher and higher simply because bundling has made it so impossible for MVPDs to continue serving the public properly. It's actually the haves and the have-nots. And it's ironic, I'm going to read it, because Les Moonves was reported by the New York Post to be advocating what the Post appropriately dubbed the take from the poor and give to the wealthy strategy. Viacom recently increased their fees by 30%. And the latest trick is I'll compromise and negotiate with you for the must-have channel, but in the process, I'm going to increase all the channels you don't want. And if you ask any MVPD right this minute, if they want the channels they have, they would say that they can easily eliminate 15 to 30 channels immediately. I'm going to put on the screen. Now, this is something that is really interesting. These are all owners of television stations. If you look at this, all the blue is white males. The pink are the two women that actually own channels. And the white is minorities. I think there's something really wrong with that. And that brings me to why I decided to launch CinemaWise, the woman-owned channel, because the state of media and ownership in terms of women is really a national disgrace. Kim Gandhi, who was former president of the National Organization for Women, said, "There are so few women's voices on broadcast television, and part of the absence of women perspective stems from the absence of women owners. We are half the population, but only, at best, 5% of station owners. And the problem is getting worse. The increasing consolidation of ownership is making women invisible. Women are considered a minority, but in fact, they are the majority. So we all know what that means. Now, the reality is that women in the economy are a huge force. 11.3 businesses are owned by women, which translate to 1.6 trillion dollars in sales. And it also means that there are 9 million people being employed by women. They did actually a research about women on the Fortune 500, and they found out that if you have 3 women on a board for 5 years, that means that company versus the one with 0 women has actually delivered 80% more sales, 64% more investment on equity, and 46% equity on equity. So the statistics actually speak for themselves. I have very little time here, so I'm not going to go too long. But I wanted just to tell you about something that's really, really crucial. Women consumers are responsible for approximately $7 trillion in spending power, representing 51% of the population. Women in the U.S. are controlling 72.8% of household spending. Women ages 50 and older control $19 trillion and own more than 3/4 of the nation's financial wealth. And this is according to Mass Mutual Financial Group. So I think that makes the argument that this industry is somehow not thinking through the reality of what our population is all about, not in terms of women, not in terms of minority, and not in terms of how do you sustain a business instead of eating its young and destroying its essence. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Mr. Franklin.
Thank you very much. Thank you for having me. Again, I'm Clifford Franklin. I'm CEO of GFN TV, as well as CEO of Fuse Advertising. I'm going to read a statement today because I think it's very important that it is a part of the public record. And it's a counter-argument to many of the comments that have been filed by the lobbyists and, sadly, by some members of the civil rights community and the Congressional Black Caucus. It is important that the FCC take action with the set-top box issue immediately, and for those who want to delay those actions, I believe needs to be addressed today. I appreciate the opportunity to participate in today's panel on diverse and independent programming. As CEO of an online streaming platform, Many of the questions being discussed in the Notice of Inquiry on Diverse and Independent Programming have been central focuses of GFN-TV's business planning. Technology has presented the video marketplace with incredible opportunities. These opportunities, however, require action and vigilance to protect against those benefiting from our anti-competitive status quo. GFN-TV is an all-video network. We have designed and built a platform that distributes premium urban video content that seamlessly runs on laptops, smart televisions, tablets, and smartphones. We are aggregating, producing, and curating the best and most relevant content available. Our content includes comedy, drama, sports, documentaries, and news from all over the world. GFN-TV is in the business of disruption. The one industry that needs disrupting more than any industry is the television programming business. Minorities, but specifically African Americans, have had their images shaped by television programming. We have literally been programmed by the programmers. We have been inundated with buffoonery, thugs, and antisocial behavior for years, and this imagery has a direct effect on society. And we can't blame this on the handful of minority programmers. We have to blame it on a system that needs to embrace emerging technologies and emerging minority businesses. Increasingly, consumers are turning to digital networks to be entertained. Finally, there are greater options for consumers who may not want to be relegated to music videos and reruns of Good Times and Martin. A growing number of minority-owned streaming services are focusing on African-American content and African content. And a growing number of independent filmmakers are developing original content in long and short form. They no longer have to beg Hollywood for a pilot show anymore. An open internet allows for their pilot to be seen by millions in real time. Online video is thriving. Advertising dollars are shifting to these video networks and soon will reach $50 billion. But as you heard from the brother with the African channel, when you only have 10 million households, it's very difficult to get those ad dollars. Minority programmers no longer are in a position where they can afford to be shut out of this game. The ANA filed comments this past Friday, basically saying that cable box competition is bad for advertisers. In its filed comments, the group argued that advertising plays an important role in content creation, programming viability, and cost to consumers for such content, and that the rule change will jeopardize advertising many contributions to the economic and other interests of the public. This is laughable. It should be noted when reviewing the ANA's comments that they represent one of the most racially polarizing industries with a history of lack of diversity and discriminatory practices. Many of the largest African-American ad agencies are a shell of themselves, with several going out of business in the past 3 years. This is due to members of the ANA that compensate minority agencies with a small fraction of the budget that they pay general market agencies. This is due to members of the ANA that have taken media budgets from minority agencies and consolidated them at general market media buying shops. I was recently having dinner with one of my political consultant friends, and he asked me how was Fuse Advertising doing. I said, we're doing well considering we get 10% of what you make for the same work. There was, of course, the awkward 10 seconds and a little bit of empathy. The advertising industry and television programming go hand in hand, and these industries need to be disrupted. Minorities have been closed out since the beginning of these industries. We need more competition, not less. Online video has globalized the video ecosystem. GFN-TV and other OTT video programmers are engaging customers and content providers both domestically and abroad. Although the formal focus of this FCC proceeding is related to domestic video programming, I urge the FCC to consider the international marketplace and how best to promote the growth and sustainability of U.S. companies in an international marketplace. GFN-TV is currently negotiating distribution in emerging markets in Africa. I will have a better opportunity for fair compensation and growth there than in the U.S. unless this cartel is broken up and fairness is instituted. We are now in a position where there is robust, highly entertaining urban video content available. But the reality is television is still the way to reach the masses. Fortunately, the FCC has the ability to create this opportunity for independent and minority programmers, but it must act soon before cable operators can establish themselves as the only gatekeepers to the online video market. We need a path to greater distribution of this content, and the way to do this is to have a competitive set-top box or no set-top box system. Online video minority programmers will not be able to grow and thrive with the current system. The track record of the cable channels and the telecoms is clear. It defies logic to have reasonable expectations that independent programmers will ever get a fair deal by negotiating with their competitors for carriage and compensation. Could we honestly believe Pepsi would have gotten anywhere if its growth and successes were subject to the whims and wishes of Coke? Do we think Microsoft or Apple have any chance at success if they had to first get the blessing of IBM before they could sell any products? And surely we are not so naive to believe that Chrysler would have grown into a major producer of automobiles if Chrysler's only path to viability went through Ford. The economics of the cable industry presents economic scenarios inherently opposed to independent participation. I applaud those that continue to battle against the impossible economics of our current MVPD systems. The Estrella TV case against Comcast represents the best current illustration of the challenges faced by independent programmers. According to the complaint filed in the Estrella case, Estrella TV was removed from cable systems in multiple markets. The network also alleges that it was denied compensation for carriage. It further asserts that they were being forced to accept an agreement that would require Estrella to surrender its digital rights, very similar to what you spoke about. Estrella also alleges that all of these disruptive actions were taken in order to benefit Estrella's Spanish language programming competitors, Telemundo and NBC Universal, both owned by Comcast. The complaint reads like a vertical integration economics exam hypothetical. But you know, the problem is it's not hypothetical. This is a real case and it's not isolated. Due to significant barriers and challenges to sustainability, GFN-TV has focused on OTT models. Through the application of technology, we seek to present programming free from the constraints of a cable system that has led to the untimely demise of too many good ideas. New Urban Entertainment, a Quincy Jones-backed venture, the Black Education Network, the Employment Channel, and many others are unfortunate examples of our regulatory system's past failures in ensuring a free, open, and non-discriminatory video marketplace. Independent programmers, like other businesses, must have freedom of market access and freedom to set their own compensation models in these marketplaces. These OTT companies also need support in ensuring the playing field remains level and resistant to anti-competitive practices that accompany every advanced technology. It is important, as we go through this conversation, that when you look at the minority programmers who are basically shilling for Comcast and saying that this will hurt their competition and their ad revenue model if this is open up, that means that they just have to be more competitive. That means that they have to have more quality entertainment. This thing should be opened up for all programmers, but specifically minority programmers and African-American programmers who have been shut out of this system. Thank you very much.
Mr. Gotch.
I'm one of those guys that can't walk and chew gum at the same time, so Billy will move it. I want to thank the FCC for hosting this workshop and inviting RFD-TV to speak about the critical issues impacting independent programmers in today's video marketplace. I'm here today not only in my capacity as the founder of RFD-TV, but also as a representative of the public who, out of frustration and a growing concern with their cable company, have filed more than 100,000 complaints with the FCC over the past 3 years in support of rural and senior-oriented programming that RFD-TV provides. Coincidentally, our own frustration reached a climax the day before the FCC announced this NOI when RFD-TV, as a last resort, placed full-page ads in both the New York Times and Washington Post in an attempt to stop Verizon from dropping RFD-TV from its Fios TV lineup. Verizon ignored the ads, as well as over 50,000 customer requests sent directly to Verizon's New York offices, and after 8 years, Verizon unceremoniously removed RFD-TV from over 5.3 million homes. Only FCC intervention can fix this critical problem for independent channels, who now lack any leverage against these media giants and whose distribution can be wiped out with a 30-day notice. RFD-TV is a true independent that brings original, unduplicated content to consumers, not only in rural markets, but also in urban and suburban markets with the goal of reconnecting city with country again. For the past 15 years, RFD-TV has been the nation's only 24-hour television network featuring programming focused on agribusiness, equine, rural lifestyle, western sports, and traditional family-friendly entertainment. Nielsen and RenTrak rated, RFD-TV is consistently ranked in the top 100 for all cable channels in primetime and embraces the fact that this channel attracts its largest percentage of viewers from senior citizens. RFD-TV has become the news and information programming channel representing rural America. We produce more than 30 hours per week of rural-focused live newscasts, including daily reports from our news bureau at the U.S. Department of Agriculture here in Washington, D.C., which provides information relevant to rural interests about developments from the White House, Capitol Hill, and at federal agencies. Never has there been more a glaring need for such a service than in the current presidential races. In all the debates and town hall broadcasts to date, the urban-based national media has failed to ask a single question concerning any rural issue. By contrast, in 2015, RFD-TV launched its Rural Town Hall series that provides voters with an opportunity to see every U.S. presidential candidate appear before a live audience while responding to questions affecting agriculture and rural interests. Yet this unique programming has no chance to even be seen in over 60 million U.S. television households. RFD-TV also meets the programming needs of senior citizens by showcasing rural lifestyle and traditional country music programming on nights and weekends, which is not available from any other channel. AARP also airs monthly specials exclusive to RFD-TV. Nevertheless, RFD-TV has faced several significant distribution challenges in recent years. The reality today is that the video distribution is controlled by a small number of urban-based MVPDs, and many of those MVPDs have demonstrated a bias against rural and senior American content, as evidenced by the following chart. While RFD-TV's issues with Comcast and Verizon have been notable and public, equally challenging has been the sharply limited carriage by Cox, Bright House, Time Warner, and Cablevision. Taken together, these MVPDs have demonstrated a persistent unwillingness to distribute RFD-TV to more than 5% of their subscribers. Why are these MVPDs blocking RFD-TV distribution into over half the television homes in America? Is RFD-TV asking for exorbitant fees? No. RFD-TV's very low cost is consistently ranked as a best bargain by Independent Cable Magazine's annual survey of cable operators. Is this one of those public rate disputes? No. RFD-TV has never raised its rate and has never experienced a rate dispute with any cable operator. Does RFD-TV have poor or deteriorating ratings? No. RFD-TV was shown to be the 81st most popular cable channel in primetime in a recent Variety magazine article. While most other channels are struggling to hold audience share, RFD-TV has realized double-digit growth in its Nielsen ratings each year for the past seven years. Is RFD-TV airing duplicated programming that can be found on other channels? Again, no. RFD-TV produces all original content and proudly airs a wide variety of programming from nearly 100 independent program producers who are exclusive to this network. Are subscribers to these MVPD cable systems not requesting RFD-TV or RFD-HD? Obviously, RFD-TV enjoys support like no other channel, as evidenced by the public comments filed with the FCC. What is the answer, then, as to why? It's simple. RFD-TV is an independent channel caught up in the present-day reality of consolidation of the video marketplace, where price, ratings, original content, and consumer demand means absolutely nothing. RFD-TV has done everything right, yet its future now solely rests in the hands of a few urban-based executives who clearly have another agenda other than providing a wide variety of programming options to their subscribers and meeting the demands of even their own customers. This lack of carriage cuts RFD-TV off from any cable distribution in 20 of the top 25 markets in this country, markets where Nielsen overnight ratings are measured. It is imperative that RFD-TV have access to these markets because ratings in these markets determine the rates that advertisers are willing to pay for airtime on the channel and puts our programming at a tremendous disadvantage against the bundled channels that enjoy such carriage and distribution. RFD-TV has also experienced additional setbacks in recent years in even retaining existing distribution in this rapidly consolidating media landscape. In particular, in August 2013, Comcast, after its merger with NBC Universal, dropped RFD-TV from carriage throughout Colorado and New Mexico, again with only a 30-day notice affecting 470,000 customers. When I flew to Denver to address the situation with Comcast, armed with RFD-TV's strong ratings and over 4,000 letters from Comcast subscribers asking for reinstatement, I was told point blank by the regional executive, we needed to take down one channel to launch others by contract, and I chose RFD-TV. We then took these same materials along with letters from the city of Pueblo and even the governor of Colorado to Comcast corporate headquarters, but were told that the decision is irreversible. When queried, Mr. Cohen's only explanation in the May 2014 House Judiciary Subcommittee hearing was that Comcast was primarily an urban clustered cable network. MVPTs have been touting the diversity of programming available today by pointing their programming aimed at African American, Hispanic, and Asian American populations. And while these efforts are commendable and supported by RFD-TV, they also reflect a limited view of what constitutes diversity in America. Rural America and senior citizens are among the largest underserved populations in America, continually being ignored more and more by broadcast and cable television. Having a small number of corporations focus on their particular understanding of diversity is failing to vindicate the programming needs of all of America's underserved populations. I also believe that lengthy subscriber contracts and early termination fees have the effect of insulating distributors from their decisions because consumers cannot easily respond by switching providers. Indeed, many Verizon customers filed comments in this proceeding explaining that they subscribed to Fios TV specifically to obtain RFD-TV. One would think that Verizon's $725 million loan from Farm Credit Services to expand rural communications would have been incentive enough not to purge their only rural channel, but it was not. Bundling practices by major programmers also have the effect of squeezing out independent voices. Today, six major media companies control the vast majority of programming revenues, and they demand that MVPDs carry all their channels. As a result, MVPDs must carry upwards of 60 or 70 channels before they can even think about carrying a genuinely independent voice. If there is one thing that unites all of rural America is that we have to do a better job of communicating with our urban neighbors. Again, the over 100,000 comments filed by RFD-TV viewers over the past 3 years demonstrate that RFD-TV's unique rural programming appeals to a truly diverse audience, transcending gender, race, age, and geography. These comments also show the critical need for FCC intervention, as all else is failing to resonate with these MVPD and media conglomerates. It is because of the foresight of the 1992 Cable Act that RFD-TV even exists, and the FCC should make sure that this vision continues. RFD-TV applauds the FCC for taking steps to investigate the hurdles independent programmers face in reaching consumers, and we encourage the FCC to move quickly to implement rules to preserve rural and senior-oriented programming. Otherwise, RFD-TV and many other independent channels now risk being one 30-day notice from extinction.
Thank you very much. Mr. Morris.
Thank you.
Thank you. And I apologize, I'm going to have to stand up here because I can't see it. So. I'm Craig Morris, president of RIDE TV. I want to thank the FCC for holding these hearings today. We think it's very important. RIDE Television Network is a 24/7 independent television network dedicated to the equestrian rural lifestyle. RIDE was launched October 1st, 2014, currently has distribution with Dish, Armstrong Cable, CenturyLink, Windstream, Shantel, Verizon, and a few other smaller operators. RIDE TV is also being distributed in Latin America and very soon will launch its own OTT platform. Independent channels serve America. 30 million Americans ride horses each year. There are 20,000 horse shows across the U.S., and 1 in 63 Americans are directly employed in the horse industry. RIDE TV's programming includes live sports, travel shows, reality shows, children's programming, other great programming that's family-friendly and great content. RIDE TV invests heavily in our own content. We produce over 90% of our content ourselves. Today, RIDE TV focuses primarily on this market, but it's expanding into programming serving viewers involving ranching, farming, that live in urban and rural areas. RIDE TV has enormous capacity to serve. RIDE TV is well-funded. We have very notable shareholders who are committed to providing important content that improves television programming landscape, such as Alice Walton, John Paul DeJoria, and several other millionaires and billionaires. Many independent channels are great concepts, well-funded, serve very important segments of American TV viewers, but still face severe challenges in today's MVPD programming ecosystem. We know that not all MVPDs are created equal. Truthfully, most MVPDs don't want to launch new channels. Fortunately, RIDE TV has found some who do, such as Terry Denson from Verizon, Warren Schlichting from Dish, David Whitman from Armstrong, and a few members of Charter and some others. Some of the comments that we've faced over the last 2 years of trying to get carriage from some of the larger MVPDs were, if you had retrans or other channels to trade, you would have a big stick to hit us over the head with, but since you don't, you have no leverage and we don't have to launch you. The reality is, no MVPD wants to launch new channels, and as an independent, it's going to be very tough for you. Another comment was, we don't have any bandwidth, and even if we did, we would only consider launching you if you were free. The super programmer effect. This is something that has a tremendous effect on smaller independent programmers. Mammoth super programmers who leverage bundled channels and retrans rights to launch their new channels and raise rates have helped squeeze out independent channel launches. This is the super programmer effect. RIDE TV has been told by MVPDs that they won't launch independent channels. They don't know when another bundle because they don't know when another bundled channel will be forced on them. Many of the challenges for independents are super programmers forcing rate hikes, new channel launches through channel bundling and leverage retrans rights. MVPDs claim they have no bandwidth and cannot pay for new channels, but continue to launch and pay for channels belonging to super programmers. Most favored nation clauses that essentially are price fixing. And there's no equity in subscriber fees regardless of viewership, quality of programming, or even the affinity base. What we think can be done. We would like to see eliminating MFN clauses or make them two-way to bind them also to the MVPDs. Encourage MVPDs to replace non-performing bundled channels with independent channels with no fear of retaliation from the super programmers. If you would not allow MVPDs to restrict programmers' rights to offer their product through their own OTT offering, we would like to see it considering rules that require MVPDs to offer one independent channel for every two non-independent channels to serve more of America. And we definitely need to redefine the definition of independent channels, I think. We would like for you also to consider forming an independent channel advocacy board that reports to the FCC and Justice Department that would assist indie channels with launch negotiations. We really believe that a lot of people do not understand what a small independent channel faces when he goes out and tries to gain carriage. And the game really is, from the big guys, if nobody launches you, nobody has to. And that, along with the MFN issue, which makes your worst deal your best deal, makes it nearly impossible for an independent programmer to gain carriage today, a small independent programmer. So we believe that to serve the public interest, that FCC does need to do something. We do need to take a hard look at the rules and make sure that everybody has an equal and level playing field. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Now, as those here in the room consider their questions. I'll seed the clouds with a question that I think arises because of the somewhat different business models of the various speakers here. As we consider the revenue streams available to an independent programmer, either from traditional MVPD carriage, advertising, or over-the-top carriage, can you generalize as to what is the proportion of those revenue streams, and is it necessary to have all three in order to have a viable channel?
I believe you do need all three to be able to be relevant, because number one, you cannot get any advertising revenues unless at a minimum you hit 30 to 40 million households, and then you really are not considered an avenue until you have 55 million. You also need the other revenue because you're dealing with programming that are costly nowadays. And the ironical part is that the media giants, for a lot of the independent channels, actually control the programming as well. And their rate card is going up, 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 while they are shutting out the independents because they are basically trying to monopolize all the bandwidth. At the same time, when you have a vertical integration occurring and the bundles, there's no more revenues that are available from the MVPD point of view to pay new channels. So the new channels are based, the independent channels are basically dependent on the crumbs that are left behind if they are lucky enough to be able to be launched in the first place. So they definitely need the three resources for revenues in order to sustain. The OTT market, as you know, doesn't give them enough exposure as yet, and in fact, it's a search engine nightmare. So you're dealing with a situation where you're very restricted in terms of your own growth to be able to serve the public in the best possible way.
I would say in the OTT market, and subscriber fees is the main gather of revenue, and it's the best way to sort of get around advertising, particularly in the minority market where advertising is going to be a serious problem anyway. But what people are doing is beginning to innovate and replace traditional advertising with branded content. So essentially working with advertisers to create new content to be programming on some of those channels. So it doesn't necessarily look like commercials, but to create their own documentaries that are branded in that sense, that look or imitate programming, and having them pay for advertising in that way, as opposed to your regular commercials that might go, you know, before or after a program.
Yeah, in RFDTV's case, we're becoming more and more and more dependent on advertising revenue with our particular model. As we launched as a public interest channel, where we could not sell any advertising. And so we had programmers pay, we had the audience support. We developed several revenue streams. But now, especially with, I cringe every time there's a fight with a MVPD and one of the must-carry stations where they're forced to raise prices. I know that's going to come back and haunt us. So one cannot, in our case, increase our revenue by expecting affiliation fees, and in some cases we're even lowering our monthly price. But having access to these 20 of the top 25 markets where we're being shut out is critical for our future.
And Eric is right. It has to be a hybrid model in order to survive. It's important for us to be able to generate ad revenue, but also balance that with branded content because, you know, frankly, the rates that minority programmers receive is always lower than what the general market receives. So you find yourself getting less than, even if you have the eyeballs. And then when you look at the subscription-based model, that becomes even more difficult because there's only so many bills the consumers are going to have a month, which is why we're focusing across emerging markets as well in order to balance out our revenue model.
And is it possible then today to have a business model that depends on over-the-top coverage and advertising but not on traditional MVPD carriage?
Let me jump in again. I think it's impossible think about launching a new independent channel right now. The conditions have changed so much from when we first launched 15 years ago. We could not launch RFD TV today, just from the changes with the MVPs, that the change in their attitudes, as I explained in my statement. We're doing everything right. And if channels that are doing everything right, that are holding down costs, not raising rates, marketing with the and partnering with the cable companies, are getting dropped, then what chance does a new channel have of even getting launched? And that's why FCC intervention is absolutely necessary.
Yeah, I can speak for the new channel getting launched side for sure. It's absolutely very, very tough right now. And as far as being sustained strictly off OTT and advertising revenue, especially if you're focused in any type of the rural markets, some of them, it's not available there yet. Some of it's not available to get high-speed internet streaming, things like that. So it makes it very, very difficult, and it has to be a blended model right now in order to survive.
When an independent channel does achieve MVPD carriage, what's the typical length of years of those contracts, those carriage contracts? Is there a typical term?
Approximately 5 years on average.
Some of them want 8 years and 2 years free nowadays. And some of them require the new channel to pay a certain amount of money towards marketing and advertising, so they say, but it's basically a pay-or-play situation. So it makes it very difficult unless you have the deep pocket. I mean, in our case, we created the channel specifically, as I said before, I wanted to make sure that there was a woman channel because there was such a scarcity. But we created the channel with an upscale point of view, basically wanting to appeal to the luxury brand market, and we've succeeded somewhat. But the reality is, unless you have the distribution and the exposure, it's not valued by the advertiser, or even in terms of branding type of sponsorships. So you're limited, and unless you have the staying power, as an independent new channel nowadays, you cannot sustain. It's a one-way ticket to bankruptcy.
Thank you. Now we'll open up to questions from the group present. We can bring you a microphone so that it'll be captured on the recording. It's coming.
Sorry. Mr. Newton, I have a couple questions for you. You mentioned that your agreements with some very large MVPDs have alternative distribution mode provisions in them. Is that something that was forced upon you? You negotiated? Do you feel they're anti-competitive in nature? I was hoping you could speak a little bit about that. And then I was wondering, are those provisions that you have in your agreements, are they just for where the MVPD operates? Or is it throughout the United States? And is there a difference on whether the deployment on an alternative distribution method is paid or unpaid?
So to the first part of your question, it was forced upon us. That was part of the original agreement when the channel was launched back in 2005. As it relates to the scope, it relates particularly to the U.S. So international has become a big part of our strategy as it relates to just increasing revenue overall, because it doesn't preclude us from distributing over the top, if you will, in Canada or emerging markets like in Africa, where we've invested a lot of infrastructure to begin distribution there. But as it relates to the U.S., literally that the timing that we have allotted that we can offer content for free online, it just resorts to promotional materials. We use it for social, so based on that 10-minute cap per day, we end up cutting a lot of short-form interstitials, things that we can seed our content to our audience across various social platforms to just try to bring more people into the tent. And that's what we've been using to kind of make our case for further distribution domestically and saying, hey, there is an appetite for this content. There's a huge population of African expats in markets like Philadelphia, where Comcast is based, that we don't have distribution in. Markets in like D.C., for instance, to have a huge Ethiopian and Eritrean population, where we have, I think if you look at where we're distributed, our penetration is still below the 50% mark in 9 of the top 10 highest populated African-American households. So our biggest challenge is understanding the justification as to why our brand doesn't make sense. I think when you look at the programming that's AA-focused and targeted, there's tons of redundancy in old episodes of movies. at movies that have been on since I was a child, basically. And then you have the Africa Channel that's offering a much broader perspective. You know, you've seen the clip, there's food, there's culinary, there's travel for an audience of color. And then we refresh content at an enormous rate every 6 months. Just this April, we refreshed with over 220 hours of new programming. I'd put that against almost any network in the market to date right now in terms of refreshing at that capacity. But for us, it's about just offering something unique, something fresh that hasn't been seen. And 95% of our programming has never been broadcast here in the U.S. And it's, for the most part, it's all English-speaking HD content.
Do others have thoughts to express about these ADM clauses? Thank you. Other questions?
I think, Mr. Franklin, I think you mentioned the Estrella proceeding and also your interest in opening up the box. Mm-hmm. I was curious about your views or anyone else on the effectiveness of the program carriage proceedings and what the commission should look for in terms of going forward within the OTT environment for similar kind of proceedings.
Well, I think it's important that they move swiftly, and I believe that the comments that have been filed are deliberate in trying to slow down this current administration of making a decision regarding the set-top box issue. The facts are clear about the competitive environment. We've heard it from every panelist, everybody's agreements. So we know that there is an issue of a monopoly, so to speak, among the major cable carriers. So it is our hope that the FCC moves with expediency to open this thing up. It's important for the survival of many of the new content creators, particularly in the urban environment. You have so much content that's available that will never see the light of day unless it can be put on independent channels. The mainstream channels, particularly African-American channels, are struggling with content because they get such low carriage fees. They find themselves running the old cheapest content they can find, so there's not quality programming available. Again, the facts are clear. So in order to move the dialogue forward, we are urging the FCC to move immediately to have a competitive set-top box.
Other questions?
Hi, thank you, everyone. This is more of a comment, and I think to Mr. Morris's note earlier. I myself own an over-the-top platform recently launched in the United States, and it's aimed exactly at this diversity that makes up what America is today, everything I think the panel has discussed, and the urgent need to address the main problem, which really is who's hurting here is the consumer. And I think that you mentioned, Mr. Morris, a potential for an independent advocacy committee that really discusses these issues in a format that allows us, even as emerging solutions, for example, even me as a platform that would love to do business with every single one of you up there, is difficult because of these rules and established agreements that you've already made that, 5 years ago we didn't foresee some of the new technologies and emerging abilities that we would have. And I think that it also hurts new emerging solutions and companies like mine that have the want and the need to provide a service to an underserved public and that would love to even do business with all of you but need to find that hybrid ability to do so. And I think that is a great idea to find a format where we could come together and have those open discussions and grow together as companies and also open up all the new jobs and the opportunities that exist for these up-and-coming creators who we are making it more and more difficult for to create independent channels as well. So it's the established ones that are in trouble and it's the new ones that we're also overlooking the potential of job creation and the opportunity of young people getting out there and creating and finding their way through the arts, that we're also neglecting. And the consumer, of course, at the end, who we're limiting their choices with the products that are out there today. So.
Thank you. Could I also add to that as well? You know, it would give us an opportunity to independently evaluate the viability of those channels as well, or other avenues, to where the larger MVPDs don't have an opportunity to say, well, it's another stay-at-home mom's cooking channel, you know, and we don't need another one of those, or you're not well-funded, or you're not putting out enough original programming. There would be an opportunity to set some benchmarks there, and for us as a group to go in and decide what those are, decide what's viable, and push out some channels who definitely have viability, who have sustainability, and who have profitability potential to these MVPDs, and take away some of their naysayings for launching a lot of new independent channels.
In that connection, when an independent channel seeks carriage today, what are the criteria that the channel itself and the MVPD apply to decide whether carriage on a particular MVPD makes sense?
For us, you go in there and sell your tail off. That's what it is, and try and prove your market. You know, luckily enough for us, because a lot of equestrian enthusiasts around the country, and you know, there, I don't know very many Americans who, and people around the world who don't just love horses anyways, but there's membership organizations where we have actual millions and millions of people who have registered either their horses, or they registered to an organization to compete in. So we have a very identifiable market that we can show how we can reach out and touch and get our product out in front of those people, and show that we're there, and show that we're viable for the MVPDs on that side. I think that's the most important thing most of the times when you go in there with those talks, but that doesn't necessarily always guarantee that you're going to get a deal for sure.
In our case, even though, as I said before, we refuse to play the pay-to-play game with DirecTV, so at that point, the telecoms were sort of the new kids on the block. So they realized that innovation was something they needed, so they obviously distributed us. But a part of that was not about so much, yes, we showed them our programming and all of that, and they liked it. And yet, when you talk to the MVPDs today and you tell them we've had 99% growth in viewership in 1 year, they answer you, we do not have any bandwidth. We are being swallowed up by the media conglomerates. We don't have any money left. We don't have any bandwidth. You have to wait. So it's not even about content. And even though we curate every single second of our channel, it's not about that. It's about the pressure that even the MVPDs feel because of the imbalance in the entire system, which needs to be changed. You know, I gave the example that in Israel, 40% of the bandwidth is reserved for independents, and that's why that industry is thriving. And in fact, America is buying a lot of the programs from there.
Yeah. Bill, just one quick comment. I think the message everybody's trying to say is that the conditions have really changed with the cable companies. The industry was launched where they encouraged diversity, they encouraged original content, and you could get meetings. Now it's real difficult, I think, to even get a meeting. And number two, if you're brought in, you know, they'll sit there and tell you what a nice channel you got, what a great idea, and then you won't hear from anybody for 6 months. But the real important thing to understand is that's what needs to be addressed out there. Channels that have good ideas that are doing things right aren't getting the attention. And when approvals are made where people have control of access to 22 million homes, to 18 million homes, to 13 million homes, to 10 million homes, there's a fiduciary responsibility that goes with that. And the message that I'm trying to bring to the FCC is that these companies are ignoring that responsibility. They should be erring on the side of the independent channels. And instead, they seem to be pushing the envelope to see how much they can get by with. When Verizon drops the Weather Channel, the Sportsman's Channel, the Outdoor Channel, and RFD TV,
all within 1 year period, does nothing to the consumers who signed 2 year contracts, and who one of those channels is probably that one of the reasons they signed up for that channel. This situation has to be addressed. They aren't taking on their responsibility to in having access to that many homes, and the FCC, the Department of Justice, or somebody needs to remind these folks of their responsibility to the public.
Mr. Newton, you want to?
In our case, the magic word negotiation is free. I think everyone that we sit down, they love the content offering. They get who we're talking to. They know that there's a market there. Once it boils down to how much it costs, you know, they're like, oh, that's too expensive. So we'd love to entertain the idea of free carriage, but that's where the MFN comes in and prohibits that. So we could either create workarounds and say, okay, we'll negotiate a deal that's, you know, 2 years free, and then we'll make up for it on the end, but then we're at risk of being audited and having to do paybacks to Comcast and Time Warner. So we can't even give it away at this point. So I think that's why today, I think if there was any point to get across, is just about how I understand the MFN's intent, but when it comes to the independent programmer, it's extremely prohibitive.
Not only that, the first question that pretty much every major MVPD asked us when we sat down with them is, who's carrying you? So it was a very telling sign for us that as long as nobody launched us, they didn't have to. There was no competition out there that you could switch people from one carrier to another to get the particular channel. So that seems to be definitely a negotiating tactic with all of them, that no carriage is great for them, because as long as nobody puts you on the air, nobody has to.
Another question from the audience.
Hi, I'm Ellen Schnett, and I work with Cinema. And the earlier panel of independent operators really hit home and the point, and had some excellent examples of the impact of bundling on them, that they're forced to swallow these crazy demands for increased channels. And Daphne and all of you actually touched upon that here. The earlier panel also touched on the fact that the definition, I think, in this proceeding of what an independent channel is way too narrow, you know, that it's just vertically integrated with a cable operator. I mean, clearly, you know, all of you at this table really represent the true independent. And I think all of us are going to be working on providing some comments on how to better reflect that definition of independent. In my discussions with a lot of independent channels, they've come up with two ideas which to me sound interesting and viable, and I just wanted to know your opinions on them. One of which is to possibly, throughout this proceeding, if it goes into an NPRM, consider a minimum threshold that operators would have to abide by of how many independents are carried, true independents. 15%, 20% set aside for independents to at least give us some channel capacity for us to buy against. So, A, what's your idea on that? And another idea that's been raised that some of us, you know, try to kind of ad hoc put together is the idea of an independent programmer association, you know, because clearly, I mean, our friends at NCTA and others, you know, I think, you know, the operators drive NCTA, and so we really don't have that much of a voice at NCTA. So, what are your ideas on those two proposals?
I love the notion of the minimum threshold. I think that would at least give us some sort of presence of market share as it relates to bandwidth capacity. But I think that the threshold also needs to be applied to penetration, and because you can launch a network all you want, but at a minimal level of distribution with no real penetration in key DMAs, how can a network thrive and survive in that environment? So I think coupled with, you know, having just a minimum threshold of how many are let in, there should be a threshold in terms of penetration within key markets, because as I think a number of us have shared on the table, being below 30 million households is a nightmare in terms of trying to generate ad revenue. So subscriber fees become your sole revenue stream, and that's really challenging for an independent programmer.
I think advocacy organizations are fine, but the reality is that it has to be funded. We're getting beat up by the lobbyists up here in D.C. that represent these conglomerates. So the amount of money that's spent, you know, to lobby Congress, to push through these mergers is incredible. And it's going to take an extreme amount
of raising capital to be able to have our voices heard. So I think advocacy organizations are fine, but we have to think about the revenue model that goes along with that.
I also think that that's correct. We do need to think in terms of becoming capable of raising the bar in terms of the Congress and the Senate. You know, I'm having dinner tonight with Ed Markey, who's a huge leader in this issue, and Karen Bass. And the thing is that they will tell you immediately that the first thing that the FCC must do is find a way to stop this bundling and vertical integration, because there's no incentive to open the doors to innovation and newness and raise the bar on quality as long as you've given away so much of the bandwidth available to the people that are controlling everything. There's a danger of oligopoly there, and it's completely antitrust. And I think the buck stops here. We don't have the time to be able to actually contemplate that. Action must be taken, because this industry is so crucial for this population and for the world. It's the best foreign policy we've ever had. We've been the mecca of communication for decades and decades. And American people are craving better programming. You know, the exodus away from cable and satellite television is not by accident. It's not by preference. It's because of the intolerance to inferior programming, which is a part of the bundling. When you have channels that are meaningless, and any MVPD would tell you themselves that they would like to eliminate 15 to 30 channels, you know there's a problem here that's sucking up the money and the bandwidth, and all at the end is at the cost of the consumer. So it's a bigger problem than just an organization. I think action must be taken in a very serious way.
Yep. Bill, I can speak briefly about my firsthand experience with mandates. RFDTV benefited from the 1992 Cable Act, which required DBS companies to withhold reserve 4 to 7% of their bandwidth to launch public interest channels. That's how we got launched. So I'd have to say I was in support of that. But it's just a partial answer. My understanding, we applied to Dish Network in March of 2000. We were approved in November 2000 for this one slot. I was told that there were 75 other applications for that slot. So mandates and bandwidth, you know, withholding bandwidth is one thing, but then you need to address how is one going to choose which ones get it. We got lucky, and maybe that is part of growing up in this country. You need a break, but yeah, mandates worked for the DBS when they first launched, and maybe again since urban-based MVPDs are ignoring their responsibility, maybe it needs to be forced on them to at least have some chance of getting on.
Well, that and possibly a blended effort with what you've suggested with that. It's because we do have to set some sort of criteria, just like Patrick said. It was by chance that they got on, that one out of those 75 channels. So if we helped ourselves and bonded together and set some real criteria for what a viable independent channel looks like, I think that would give us some teeth then to go to the FCC with, and for the FCCs then to go to the larger MVPDs and say, we want to require you to do this. But here's the list of viable channels that are up for this.
And you mentioned forming an association. An independent network is independent for one reason. It's usually independent, and it's also independent from other channels. I've been a part of trying to organize independent channels in the past. It's like herding cats or chickens. it's very difficult to do, and there's so much diversity in independent channels themselves. I think there's very little common ground with independents, other than we're all challenged to get any kind of carriage at this point in time and retain carriage.
It's definitely tough to get a lot of entrepreneurs headed in the right direction, or the same direction, I guess I should say. But there is strength in numbers.
Another question.
Brian, you're the only one that I know of who's really spoken about the ADMs, and it's something that I haven't really been able to find too much about in literature. So I thought if you wouldn't mind just just kind of like tell us what that looks like in a contract, what the structure of that, just break it down for us, please.
And you know, I'll try to paraphrase as much as I can. So for any 30-minute piece of content, we're allowed to distribute a maximum of 10 minutes of that content per day. So from an additional distribution standpoint, literally we have to look at our content and say, okay, our maximum amount of content that we can issue is 10 minutes. So what's going to be the best use of that 10 minutes in terms of seeding our content, providing content for social and other platforms, because that's primarily how we market and advertise the brand. We don't have the resources for a lot of cross-channel spots or anything of that nature, so we look to social. So within that 10 minutes, we look at two-minute clips. We'll look at 15-second pieces for Snapchat or Instagram, one-minute pieces for Facebook, and literally that's how we look at. So for each day, we'll look at what our show schedule is and which shows we want to promote to and kind of take a deep dive into each one of those programs and say, okay, who does this speak to specifically? Let's hyper-target this piece of content towards that audience. And thankfully, social, you have the ability to do that. But by our agreement, that's the maximum of content that we can distribute per day.
So if I understand you, it sounds like with ADMs, you don't really have much of an option to distribute over the top except for just maybe some sort of advertising.
Exactly.
Like, so
we're negotiating a window now. And as we enter our renewal periods, we're negotiating at least a, let's say, a 90-day window where after, post that 90 days, we'll be able to do so. But as it stands currently, we can't take part in any over-the-top initiatives. So we've already ventured in the idea of launching an additional network that's completely free and clear so that we can take advantage of OTT platforms like Pluto TV, Zumo TV, TBTV, and a few others that play in the international landscape.
Thank you. Question?
Yes, I was wondering whether any of you in connection with cable have given any consideration to using the commercial leased access regulations or if those are simply not adequate to your purposes.
I could say I haven't.
No, because there's no revenues at all and there's no potential revenues, so it would be a hardship on independent channels to be able to do that unless you are a non-profit and then you are able to get public access. So then it makes sense because of the issue that you are trying to delve into. I've done it personally because for many years I've been involved on behalf of women and children. So that is an avenue to be able to gain public interest. But I think as a commercial channel, it would be impossible to do.
It would definitely be impossible to do and put out the type of quality content what you're used to seeing on television.
We heard discussion this morning and elsewhere of the fact that some of the MVPDs are experimenting with smaller or skinnier packages. Are those an opportunity or a threat for independent channels?
My own self, I think it could be both. It depends on the provider. Some of the MVPDs, that's going to be an opportunity for some of us to squeeze into those. From the others, if unbundling occurs with the large nine giants that we talked about who control over 100 channels out there, it could create an issue. Depending on the tactics that they'll continue to use to make sure that they get carriage for the channels that they own, it could squeeze us right out of the marketplace.
My idea, Bill, is reverse roles. Make all independent, bundle all independent channels and offer them for $15 a month and make these other guys go a la carte and go on tiers and fight for carriage. See how they like it. We heard reference to limits of bandwidth. To what extent in dealing with either large or small MVPDs, do you think that bandwidth is a serious consideration, or is it more a matter of willingness to pay?
I know for us, immediately after we talked to one of the major MVPDs, and they told us they didn't have the bandwidth, they launched the SEC network.
bandwidth tends to be the out when you're giving them when they've exhausted every other excuse as to why they shouldn't carry you. Bandwidth is the one thing you can't challenge. Because I think it's, for instance, I think it was AT&T in particular who we met with about distribution and carriage, and it was bandwidth, bandwidth, bandwidth. And the next thing we knew, they launched Revolt TV, and it was just like, wow, they cleared that up really. That happened fast. So it's just one of those things that you can't challenge, and it's, I think that's the final straw, the card that they play when you've exhausted all their other excuses.
I think the problem is the lack of willingness to look at the truth. And who are we all serving, which is the public, and, you know, that we all have a fiduciary responsibility, and the MVPDs often don't look at that. They just look at what bandwidth they have available. I had one of the heads of programming of an MVPD tell me that they are in the male sports business. I had another one tell me that the cost of launching an independent channel would be shaded by the fact that they can actually have a pay-per-view channel that would give them more money on the bottom line. So it's the lack of consciousness that is the predominance here. And I think that is what needs to be addressed, because you can get lots of reasons why the MVPDs won't do what they're supposed to do, but it's a matter of public interest and a sense of democracy that is at stake here.
I mean, it's why we need more competition, which is why it's important to open up the set-top box issue. We need more competition that forces them to not be able to bully, basically, the independent programmers.
You know, it's an interesting business, too. As you can see, I'm not an original TV guy. I came from the horse world. So when I decided to hang my shingle out and call myself a horse trainer, had the associations been able to say, no, you can't compete in this association, I'd have never been able to make a living. So this industry is very unique in that sense for me, because there's a limited amount of bandwidth out there. There is a limited amount of access to the airwaves. So for me to go in and help start this business and be a founder of this company and then have somebody tell me, no, you can't compete on my station, on my airwaves, and nowhere to go, it's a different business model. I'm a free market guy, but this is not a situation to where that's equivalent of a level playing field.
In the absence of another question from the audience, I'll ask one last question. We heard this morning the perspective of some of the smaller MVPDs and the challenges they face, in particular in carrying independent programming. Do you find that it's a different experience negotiating with a small MVPD than with the large one, and in what respect?
Yes, definitely in our case, because most of the smaller ones are rural-based companies that understand the value of rural programming. We have the opposite problem with these conglomerates. They're urban-based. Their headquarters are Philadelphia and New York and Los Angeles, and there seems to be no connection whatsoever or any value put on our programming. It's just it's a terrible meeting. So, yeah, it was the smaller cable systems after Dish and DirecTV that first launched us, and we've slowly been working our way up the ladder for the last 15 years.
Yeah, our first deals were with some smaller operators.
I think what Judy Micah said was very, very important when she said that they have had to make bandwidth available for an unnamed channel with no specifics on what the channel actually carried. I think that tells the whole story of having to be forced into it. And the other thing she said was that there was no negotiation possible on pricing or anything else, which makes it much more of an alliance with independent channels, because they understand and we understand.
Strangely enough for us, though, we got carriage with some of the smaller independent MVPDs who were members of NCTC, but we haven't been able to get a deal with NCTC. So I don't know whether they're considered one of the big guys now or not, or how they look at themselves in that, but to me there was a strange contrast with that the small MVPDs who are governed underneath that were willing to go out and enter into some agreements outside of NCTC, and us being a channel that appeals to that rural market and what have you, NCTC has yet to move.
You know, it's I love hearing that because it's true, but it's interesting because even in terms of the MVPDs, I had a long discussion with one of the head executives at Verizon who launched us, obviously, and are having a success. But he said to me, you know what, I would launch so many more independents if I wasn't forced into the corner on every negotiation. It's killing me. There's the revenue issues. There's the bandwidth issues. There's the problem that consistently I have to hire all this legal staff so many times a year to be able to continue being in business. So I think you actually have to look at that as well. They're not totally the bad guys. I think they're suffering too.
Thank you. I want to thank all of our panelists for these very valuable perspectives. And we stand adjourned. Thank you.